Are you searching for the best in online black radio? Then go to blacktalkradionetwork.com, helping you filter through the noise. Real talk, black talk.
The internet is full of half-truths and all-out lies. We've all seen them, and many people on social media complaining about it. Here's your chance to show and prove. WorldAfropedia.com is a black-owned and operated encyclopedia. There are several thousand articles, but we need help. We can't uncover all the truth ourselves. So please, join us and become a writer, editor, or blogger for WorldAfropedia.com today. Every little bit counts. We owe it to the future generations to put the truth out there. Visit WorldAfropedia.com, the African-centered encyclopedia, a global database of African knowledge for the purpose of bringing about global African wisdom and understanding. WorldAfropedia.com.
The people who classify themselves as white are not happy with their appearance. Now, they've taught us to be unhappy about our appearance. You see, but they're very unhappy about their appearance. I think there's an article in the handout about a woman who was, white woman who was in Hawaii, and she said that being around the Hawaiian people and the Asian people, and she said she was tall and white and pale. She said she felt like a freak. And so then she started getting involved in genetic science.
It sounds like science fiction, making genetically modified babies who could pass down their new genes to future generations. But it would be acceptable for science for scientists to do it under some circumstances. So, say, the National Academy of Science and the National Academy of Medicine in a highly anticipated report that was released today. NPR health correspondent Rob Stein has the details.
Scientists have been allowed to tinker with human DNA for decades, but there's always been one thing that's been considered taboo. Never try to make a baby from sperm, eggs, or embryos that have had their genes edited, because those changes would be passed down for generations to come. Alta Charo is a bioethicist at the University of Wisconsin.
In the past, it was never seriously considered permissible.
For lots of reasons. Something could go wrong and accidentally create some new disease that would become a permanent part of the human genetic code, or alter the course of human evolution in some unexpected ways. But recently, scientists created new ways to edit DNA.
It made it much faster, much easier, much less expensive to do genome editing. And suddenly, many different applications were suddenly possible. And it began to raise questions about whether and how to use the technology in human medical treatment,
including whether to try to edit the genes in human sperm, eggs, or embryos to prevent babies from being born with a long list of terrible diseases. So the National Academies put together a big committee to study this question. Today, they released their decision. Charo co-chaired that committee.
The committee says this: it is not ready now, but it might be safe enough to try in the future. And if certain conditions are met, it would be, from our point of view, permissible to try it.
Those conditions include a long list of things. There's strong evidence that it's safe. It could only be tried to prevent serious diseases like Huntington's, the fatal brain disorder, and there have to be a lot of safeguards to make sure nothing goes wrong.
If they could all be met, and we mean all of them, not just some, then we conclude it would be permissible to begin clinical trials.
And Charles stresses, it could not be tried to create so-called designer babies, where parents pick and choose the traits of their children to make them taller or stronger or smarter or better athletes or anything like that.
We said use it for serious diseases and serious conditions only, period.
Many scientists are praising the report. Eric Lander runs the Broad Institute in Boston.
It's important to be extraordinarily cautious on technologies that could leave a permanent mark on the human population for all generations to come. But it's important to be considering things that can help people. I think they've been very thoughtful about how you should balance those things.
But some say the line between preventing disease and creating genetically enhanced people will be hard to define. George Church is a prominent geneticist at Harvard.
The definition of prevention of disease is very clearly broad. It could include a lot of things that some people will consider enhancement.
And that's what makes some people very nervous.
I don't think there's any way to keep that genie in the bottle once you've approved it for anything.
Marcy Darnofsky is with the genetic watchdog group Genetics and Society.
You know, these kinds of scenarios used to be science fiction, and they used to be seen as far-off hypotheticals. But actually right now, I think there are urgent social justice questions.
Questions like whether the world's existing inequalities would only get worse.
The perception that some children are genetically improved could lead us into a society that we would really not want to live in.
At the moment, the federal government can't fund any research that would create genetically modified human embryos or approve any experiments to do so. Rob Stein, NPR News, Washington.
For decades, the two strong-willed women in Ioannidit Omotosho's new novel were committed enemies. One is black, the other is white. Their properties are next door to one another, separated by a hedge in an affluent neighborhood in Cape Town, South Africa. At the beginning of the book, they only meet at the neighborhood committee meeting, where they always fight. But an accident brings the two together, and so starts an unexpected voyage of discovery for them both. The book is The Woman Next Door, and the author, Ioannidit Omotosho, joins us from South Africa, where she lives, to talk about it. Welcome to the program.
Thank you so much. It's wonderful to be here talking to you.
It's great to have you. I want to talk about these very richly imagined characters. These are two women who are widows, they've lost their partners, their life is filled with many regrets, and they find themselves at sort of the end of their lives with not many people around them. It's unusual to have characters like these.
I definitely wasn't trying to be unusual, and sometimes stories kind of come up and say, this is the story you ought to write. And the story captures me because the other question is it ever too late to redeem yourself? Is it ever too late to forgive and be forgiven? Is it ever too late to find happiness? For these two women who are so isolated, is it ever too late to try and make friends? You know, I don't know if they ever do manage that. I like to think of what they have as a hate ship rather than a friendship. But I think all stories are important, including this one about human beings. They happen to have lived, you know, into their 80s. And yes, they happen to be women, but their stories matter just as much.
One of the things that divides these two women are not only the fact that one is black and one is white, but that they are living in South Africa. They've experienced apartheid in two very different ways. It hangs over the whole novel. Explain a little bit about how you talk about this in the book.
I was really interested in looking at what is it like, particularly for Marianne's character, to have been someone during the apartheid days who didn't necessarily resist apartheid, disagree with it, but kind of went along. What is it like now, you know, post-apartheid? What does she do with her opinions? What does she do with the mental gymnastics she had to create for herself to agree with something like an apartheid system that says this kind of skin color is better than that kind of skin color? I wanted to look at this character, or attempt to look at her, with compassion. A friend of mine who's a psychologist often says, you know, being racist is a bit like being an alcoholic. You have to be able to acknowledge your racism and your prejudice, and that's the beginning. And I wanted to have this character, Marianne, who's definitely full of prejudice and so stuck because of it, and like she cannot give it up. She's righteous and is trying to like make the last few years of her life and resist acknowledging that she was wrong, that apartheid was wrong, that it was a horror, and that these are the things it did to the country she lived in.
You write about her with a lot of compassion. It is something that's very interesting because she is a person who has such very strong views about racism and race and its place in society.
The challenge for me was that, Yoande, can you write this? You know, can you portray her and can you be fair? Can you portray her fairly? Does she deserve fairness? It can often seem kind of trite or pat, but I think part of the idea of the book is compassion is necessary. Because how do we repair without compassion? How does someone like a Marion get an opportunity to repair or to move towards repair? And I think that's an important question the world over. But definitely, you know, I live in South Africa. We're kind of 20 plus years after the democratic government was elected, and we're in repair. You know, we're attempting to talk to one another. These are races and cultures and languages that were separated. The very meaning of apartheid is apartness, separateness. So repair was very important, and compassion is very important, I believe.
One of the things that I think is so very well done in this book is how you paint the genteel white ladies at the neighborhood committee meeting. They're sort of casual, unspoken and intimate, you know, racism that manifests itself in these very tangible ways that impacts people. It can seem so innocuous, and yet it is so very present. What's important about showing that kind of micro legacy of racism?
Yeah, I think it's incredibly important to take a totally different example. We can always look and see corruption. We can look at government and we can say, oh, government is corrupt. But when we drive drunk or run the red light or whatever, we do not recognize that as a corrupting. And I'm really interested in individuals recognizing the little things, the seemingly innocuous things. And part of this whole thing is that shame still carries. You know, Marion carries a lot of shame. Underneath her anger and righteousness is a deep shame, because the humanity in her, whatever is there, knows. So how do you begin to release that if you don't address even the most innocuous things as a kind of violence? Those things have their own kind of violence.
You know, ultimately, I think what I was struck by is this is a very optimistic book. And it also feels like a very immediate one. Conflicts about race, as you mentioned, it is something obviously that are still being dealt with in South Africa, but also here in the U.S. Is there a message in the fact that these two women can become, if not friends, at least companions?
Cautious optimism, I think, is what I believe in. I think the caution is important. I didn't want to write a book with a very simple, happy ending. And I don't necessarily think that's what I did. I think it feels like it's delicate. That's the caution, that this is delicate. And I think it's important we remember, as we connect and repair, that it's delicate. And so you could tip this thing anyway at any moment. And so the optimism is as important as the caution, because we also get careless sometimes and we think, we did it. And I think South Africa, in a way, may have been careless. I don't know if that's quite the word, but if we talk now about the Rainbow Project, you know, Rainbow South Africa, the Rainbow Nation, and we sometimes talk about it disparagingly because it feels like that was too optimistic. And then we didn't do the really hard, dirty work to kind of peel underneath the scab. My sense of Marion and Hortensia is that they're just going to try and plod along. They're going to argue a lot. There might be long periods of sulking, you know, and occasionally they would have a meal or they'll sit down together. And that's okay, because it means that we're always trying and always attempting, which I think is more important than feeling like we've arrived somewhere.
Yoande Omatosho's new novel is The Woman Next Door. Thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you so very much.
All around the world.
World nigga law.
Ms. Camp Jackson, we're more than 3 weeks into the Trump administration in the United States. How concerned are you as a parent about the public discourse on race in the U.S.?
I'm very concerned, just because what I'm hearing is
overwhelmingly negative. I think there's a lot of rhetoric that's being bandied about, not only in the U.S., but it's percolating up here in Canada about, you know, quote-unquote foreigners, anti-Canadian values, that type of thing. So I am concerned that our children are hearing messages that are contrary to what I believe and what I think we believe as Canadians.
There was, of course, the attack on Muslims in Quebec City. How do you think we should talk to kids about violence that is directed at visible minorities here in Canada?
Now, while Quebec City is a horrible situation, and it's something that I hope we don't see again, the likelihood of our kids being the victims of terrorism is low. That being said, there is a high likelihood, or there is a reasonable likelihood, at least, of them having to experience racially based, you know, words, actions, slurs from other people. So I think that what happened in Quebec is a catalyst for perhaps discussions that we should be having with our kids that we might not have had before. And if we have been having those discussions, maybe we need to expand upon it in this new world order that we're in. Because I think we're going to keep hearing more and more about race and racially based actions against people of color and minorities and ethnicities.
How do you talk to your kids about racism?
I talk to them very honestly, very gingerly, but also very realistically, because in this day and age, we can't avoid it. As I said previously, they're hearing about it. You know, the U.S. election has really kind of percolated a lot of discussion about race, race relations, different ethnic backgrounds. One of my sons had mentioned something that Donald Trump said about him building a wall and how Mexicans are this and that. And that's just appalling to me. And, you know, at the same time, while I'm hearing my kids regurgitating back to me what they've heard in the larger media, it's an opportunity for me to talk to them about how I feel and how we feel as Canadians and how we embrace other cultures and how we support having different backgrounds, ethnicities, races within our community, because that's who we are as Canadians. So I think that we as parents really need to take the negative, take lemons and make lemonade out of it, and try to use this time in the world as a teaching moment for our kids.
There are some Canadians who naively believe that racism is an American problem. We certainly know that there have been many, many kinds of situations here in Canada. Are you concerned that they might increase with the election of Trump and all the rhetoric we're hearing from the United States?
I sadly do think that they will increase. I think we've already seen it. I think that, you know, I can't make a direct correlation between what happened in Quebec to Donald Trump in the U.S., but I would venture to say that there has been an emboldening of certain types of ideologies, whether it's alt-right or extreme white nationalism, against people of color, against people of different religions and ethnic backgrounds. And I think it's been facilitated by what's been happening in the U.S. So, yes, it is happening here in Canada, and I don't think that we're immune to it. And I think that we need to stop thinking that we as Canadians don't have to deal with this, because we do. We are a diverse society, but we also are dealing with a lot of rhetoric that's coming out of the States that's allowing people to feel that it's okay to say things that they might not have even said a year or two ago.
Do you think Black History Month, which is now in Canada, the month of February, is useful?
Yes, I absolutely think it's useful, because I think that there are so many negative stereotypes that are perpetuated externally, whether it's in the media or elsewhere, about Black people, Afro-Canadians, Afro-Americans, that I think it's great to counter it with some realistic and real-life examples of people who have, you know, supported and, you know, given back to our society, who are from an, you know, Afro-Canadian or Afro-Caribbean background. I am heartened by the fact that, you know, the other day after school, my kids sat down at the dinner table. I asked them what they did at school today, and they talked about Black History Month, and they said that they learned a number of things about, you know, Black and Afro-Canadian, you know, I don't know if I'd say heroes, but people who have contributed to the society. So I think that's good, because I think that as people of color, my children, I want them to learn positive things about their ethnicity, not just the negative or negativity that's often perpetuated externally.
And how do you counsel them to handle if they encounter situations of racism?
Well, I'm hoping that I have taught my children to have confidence in their abilities, have confidence in who they are as people of color, but also to stand up to it. So when they see that, you know, or they see or hear somebody saying something to them that is racially based or untoward or negative, to question it, to ask questions, to say, why did you say that to me? What did you mean by that? Why have you singled me out? To stand up to people and to bullies who might be using, you know, racially divisive terminology against them. Because if we don't stand up to people who are doing this, then they will feel that what they're doing is okay. By standing up to them and teaching our kids to stand up to this type of thing, we are putting it out there that this is not okay, it's never been okay, and it no longer will be okay, and we're going to challenge you on this. So, yes, that's what I'm teaching my kids.
Well, thank you very much for sharing with us. Really appreciate it.
Thank you so much for having me.
Then you've got to do certain specific things in economics, certain specific things in education, certain specific things in entertainment. There's a series that's coming out. What is it? The Man in the High Castle. And the book is about, and it's going to be a video series. What if the Nazis had won the Second World War? Wow. See, I mean, in other words, they got their whole little thing all tied up and timed. And so then they had swastikas all on this, in the subway station in New York. You know, in other words, this is supposed to be build up to advertisement, not to upset anybody.
I'm a fan of The Man in the High Castle, which is the Amazon show that imagines what the United States would be like if the Axis powers had won the Second World War. It's based on a Philip K. Dick novel, and it creates this alternative universe where the Nazis control the eastern half of the country and the Japanese control the west. Last month, to promote the premiere of the show's second season, Amazon installed an ad in New York City that took up an entire block.
One of the biggest billboards in the Times Square area, and it's also one of the most controversial.
Yeah, the ad for fictional show The Man in the High Castle depicts the Statue of Liberty giving a Nazi salute.
Which not everybody loved.
This is a symbol of freedom, and to have that out here, it's offensive.
Actually, I was fine with the billboard, but I do have to say that watching the second season of the show now, after the presidential election, is different than watching a year ago was. And that's what got James Poniewozik drawing some connections. He is the chief television critic for the New York Times, and he wrote about the show in an article with the headline, "An Alternative America Hits Home." I asked him, why does it hit home now?
Because there are actual real Nazis out there who are pretty psyched right now. You know, rampant on social media, on Reddit, cheering on Donald Trump. And post-election, you know, we've seen the spectacle of Richard Spencer leading his minions in a Hail Trump chant.
Well, in fact, we have a clip of that, Richard Spencer being the head of a white nationalist organization. And this conference, which took place in a federal building in Washington, not very far from the White House, just after the election.
Hail Trump! Hail our people! Hail victory!
And people during that hooray thing were actually giving Nazi salutes. Spencer afterwards said, oh, it was just exuberant. And I think he said even yeah. It was ironic in some fashion. So cut to the fiction on TV, Man in the High Castle, this new season. First episode, first few minutes, right at the beginning of the show. It's a classroom in this suburban American high school.
Class, rise. I swear I will observe the law, conscientiously fulfill my duties at home and school, be faithful and obedient, and pledge absolute allegiance until death to the leader of the Nazi Empire, Adolf Hitler.
And of course, Heil is hail. When Spencer used that phrase, hail the people, hail Trump, all that.
The parallels were not lost on him. Yes. The translations.
Now, okay, there's Richard Spencer and there are these neo-Nazis using social media and there are hundreds, thousands, I guess, of people who, in whatever sense, subscribe to this. They're not yet taking over our high schools, I guess. But I thought your article was really smart and played it correctly because we can't, if we pay attention to the news, watch this show without thinking of this part of the Trump phenomenon. There was some criticism. What did you make of that?
I expected that. I mean, I can certainly see that, you know, people are going to come across this and say, oh, the New York Times is saying Trump is Hitler, you know, and right. I tried to, you know, make the point in the piece. Look, this TV show is not a documentary. You know,
it's a work of art.
There's a lot of space between Trump is literally Hitler and yes. Everything is fine. Yes. And a lot of the stuff in that space is, you know, bad enough on its own.
Right.
I'm sorry, you know, I come from a Jewish family. When I see people in a, you know, gathering in Washington, D.C. giving the Nazi salute, I do feel an eerie relevance. You know, that's not the same as saying Donald Trump is totally a Nazi.
Right.
And I think people are wrong to read that, you know, that end of that. But it's disturbing.
And your kicker made me go, which was about how reality sort of had overtaken this fiction. Quote, if you wanted to ask what would I do if it happened here in the past, you had to watch a TV show, implying that Americans now have to ask themselves, what will I do because it now may actually happen here?
Yeah, which is not to say that we're being ruled by Nazis, but you're seeing the stirrings of things that are illiberal, anti-democratic, bigoted. One thing that I led into that with is that in the new season of The Man in the High Castle, one of the curiosities is that in this alternative history, it turns out that there were, in fact, still Japanese American internment camps. And it went differently in this case in the show. Mild spoiler alert, but you know they were we lost the war. They were liberated by the Japanese, and the Japanese Americans held there were viewed hostily by the conquering Japanese. But in any case,
which is a great fictional twist.
Segue from that to the fact that not long after the election, a Trump supporter was being interviewed on Fox News by Megyn Kelly, asked about Donald Trump's Muslim immigration ban, a Muslim entry ban, justified it by citing the historical precedent of Japanese American internment camps.
I know the ACLU is going to challenge it, but I think it'll pass. And we've done it with Iran back a while ago. We did it during World War II with Japanese, which, you know, call it what you
Come
will,
on.
maybe
you're
wrong.
Not, you're not proposing we go back to the days of internment camps, I hope.
No. I'm not proposing that at all, Megan. But what I am
you know
saying
better
is
than
that
to
we
suggest
need to protect
that.
America,
I mean, that's the kind of stuff that gets people scared, Carl.
Right. But I'm just saying there is precedent for it. And I'm not saying I agree with it. But in this case, I absolutely believe that a regional
base. You can't be citing Japanese internment camps as precedent for anything the president-elect is going to do.
Yes. This is not an exact parallel to, you know, fascism in the 1930s or the 1940s. You know, it doesn't have to, like, nothing bad comes on you all at once. And even if it's not the same kind of bad
right.
thing, when you start encountering these things, that's when you start asking yourself, you know, you start asking yourself, I'm actually living in a situation where, you know, things like this are being talked about. And getting back to The Man in the High Castle, I think that one thing that has been very interesting about that show, it's not the greatest show on television, but some of the most interesting things it does, I don't know if you'd agree with this, is dealing with the culture of occupied America, which is
right.
basically asking themselves, what would a fascist occupied America look and feel like? They very carefully thought through, oh, what would the popular music be like? Well, you'd remove all the non-Aryan influences and, you know, it would be this very sort of bubblegum pop.
Right.
I think there's a Rock Hudson movie in the first episode, that sort of thing.
Well,
but deracinated in that way. And it brings up this sort of, you know, curious insinuation that if you were if an invading army were creating a fascist America at that time, you'd have some raw materials here that you could build. You know, it's not just like imposing Teutonic culture on a subjugated country.
The other thing you mentioned that's in the second season that sounded really interesting, which is a police show on TV that seems to, that justifies the police state Nazi tactic.
American Reich, it's called.
Now you listen and you listen good, mister.
You cops, always towing the Nazi line.
Let's say we tow your line.
Sieg Heil.
American Reich, coming this fall.
Again, in this American world of Nazi-occupied America, there's still primetime television. You know, there's still very almost familiar looking
like
diversions.
Dragnet?
It basically is modeled on a Dragnet type television show. That's, you know, it's not to say the original Dragnet was authoritarian in its way. It wasn't fascist, but you know, but there are elements of familiar culture that you can take, put a little spin on them, and they can be adopted to these sort of purposes.
And the Grammy goes to girl. 25. Adele.
If you ever wanted a reason to stop giving the Grammys any credence at all, last night, you got it. In one of the most awkward things I can remember seeing on an award show stage, Adele literally broke her award trophy in half for Album of the Year, saying it also belonged to Beyonce. Look, Adele had a great song on a decent album, while Beyonce had an album that legitimately changed America. Even Adele knew that. She genuinely spent time on the podium talking about how important it was, and just for kicks, noted that it motivated her black friends to get out and do something. Gee, thanks. Overlooking the work of black artists when it comes to handing out official awards is nothing new, but this just felt wrong. If the very person who won is praising the person who didn't, you might want to reevaluate your judging process. Beyonce made the Album of the Year, whether she got the Grammy to prove it or not. I'm Clinton Yates, and that's my take.
I don't know, you know, it's awful. You wonder why a nigga don't go completely mad.
Good evening to you, friends. The court of public opinion is varying on a judge and the horrible things he's accused of saying.
The accuser is quiet for the cameras today, but very vocal on Facebook. Here's Scotty Hunter.
It's a six-letter word that has sent shockwaves across the community.
We come here today to stand in solidarity with Ms. Johnson.
A Baton Rouge woman posting on Facebook a week ago that District Judge Mike Irwin allegedly hurled the N-word at her several times during a heated argument over a seat at Sammy's Grill on Highland Road.
Nigga!
The restaurant has since banned the judge, but today, the accuser, Kenitra Johnson, joined by her attorneys, community activists, and a host of elected officials, say they want the judge to step down immediately.
We feel that it's impossible for Judge Irwin to serve the people of East Baton Rouge Parish in a fair and equitable manner.
One of Johnson's attorneys says they're filing a formal complaint against the judge through the state's Judiciary Commission. The group wants a thorough investigation into the claims, and in the meantime, they say Irwin should be suspended.
We all have the right to be able to be heard and to be given respect and dignity by any judicial official, especially on or off the bench.
So far, Irwin has remained silent, and today, when given the opportunity to speak, Johnson declined as well, her attorney saying the matter is still too fresh.
Honestly, at this time, she's a bit too emotional to address any questions.
A spokesperson with the sheriff's office confirms deputies were called out to the restaurant after the alleged incident, saying several people inside were interviewed, but no one recalled hearing the argument or the N-word. The race-fueled allegation has sparked an online debate, with some questioning the claims and some praising Johnson for her bravery. Still others bringing up a past post where it appears Johnson herself used a version of the N-word online. Less than an hour after the press conference, Johnson took to our Facebook page, where it appears she is publicly defending her alleged use of the word, saying, quote, "The word used towards me was N-I-G-G-E-R, which has been documented as a racial slur. The term I used is often used in the black community," end quote. We reached out to Johnson's attorney to clarify her meaning of the Facebook post, but at this time have not heard back.
Now, we also reached out to a representative with the Louisiana Supreme Court to find out if they've received a complaint. To see that statement and some insight on where the claims could go from here, head to our website right now, WAFB.com.
I want to be a cop.
Here's when this comment was made on Facebook. It wasn't just visible to anyone, but a screenshot of that comment has become very public, and that's when it became a problem.
It's easy to tune out comments on social media.
Truthfully, I would probably just
keep scrolling.
But this comment has turned into a hot topic for Price Police.
Wow, dude, like, come on, you put that on Facebook. So eventually somebody's going to see it.
Unhappy citizens who saw this screenshot of the comment have been calling the department to complain, so much so that the Price Police Chief confirmed he launched an investigation. What does it say? Well, the person wrote, quote, "Old Busta once again demonstrated the prime example of a typical coward." Then the man wrote the N-word.
Nigga!
He later writes he doesn't use the term much, but when he does, it's equivalent to a satanic person, kind of like saying Obama.
Damn you, Obama.
Now, Price Police won't comment any more on the investigation, except to say the comment, if true, is unacceptable. They will take the investigation seriously, and they do have a social media policy. Residents we showed the comment to had plenty to say about the accusation.
Although he was portraying his personal beliefs, but that can also reflect on the department itself.
That's his own beliefs. He can go ahead and believe that. But just because he's a police officer, he needs to be more careful.
His opinion raises questions on how he would treat people.
They're concerned if the officer did indeed make the comment, how this opinion could carry into his work. Either way, they say police should be held to a higher standard, even if on a private social media page.
To say that on social media, to say the N-word like that, and be a police officer? Yeah, that's a little crazy to me. That kind of blows my mind a little bit.
Now, we have reached out to the person who supposedly made that comment, but have not heard back. In Price, Lauren Steinbrecher, Fox 13 News, Utah.
And this developing story tonight, a Jackson community activist home is spray painted with the letters KKK, and then it is torched. Some believe the Klan is responsible. As Roslyn Anderson reports tonight, it is being investigated as a possible hate crime.
Said that I need to come home, that someone had left a note on my door.
Respect Our Black Dollars President Stanley Wesley said he saw something much more disturbing after returning to his South Jackson home Thursday night. He found the letters KKK painted on his front door and pavement. A note was also posted containing a racial slur and the message to stop now. It also read, KKK, you took my flag, payback.
We got home, smelled smoke. So we knew it was a little more serious than just painting walls.
Wesley's group has protested numerous businesses that openly sold drug paraphernalia. A news conference was held at City Hall about the incident.
We are calling on all citizens to be vigilant in these times. If you see something going on in your neighborhood that's out of place, people out of place, we want you to report those things to the police department.
Hate crimes, intimidation tactics certainly is not going to be tolerated in the city of Jackson. The days for that are long gone.
Jackson fire officials are investigating the case as arson. Wesley says he's been contacted by the FBI. In Jackson, Roslyn Anderson.
Law and liberation. From the rise of the Black Lives Matter movement, now comes the rise of law for black lives. A collective of lawyers, law students, jailhouse lawyers, and other legal workers in support of the latest iteration of the black freedom movement. It couldn't come at a better time. For times of social movements need all the legal assistance it can muster. For those who oppose that system of white supremacy and rampant necrophobia are often targeted by that same system for special punishment. Perhaps the most renowned black lawyer in U.S. history, Charles Hamilton Houston, who trained Thurgood Marshall in the law, taught his students, a lawyer's either a social engineer or he's a parasite on society. Today, of course, he'd say she. Marshall, Houston's star pupil, who later went on to become the nation's first black Supreme Court justice, would recount one of his law professor's most potent lessons. There's no law on our side? Let's make some. I carry these words to L4BL. Let's make some. But I hasten to add this lesson from a jailhouse lawyer. The law is a tool of the state, often used for repression. Where are the lawyers challenging unjust and unconstitutional laws like Clinton's Anti-Terrorist and Effective Death Penalty Act, known as AEDPA, A-E-D-P-A, or the Prison Litigation Reform Act? These so-called laws were designed to enshrine injustice in statute. The gay rights movement forced the fall of DOMA, the patently unconstitutional Defense of Marriage Act. It's time for the black freedom movement to force the fall of AEDPA and PLRA, acts based on lies and injustice, which have contributed to mass incarceration. I've quoted a preeminent law professor. Now, let me quote an outlaw, revolutionary naturalist John Africa of the MOVE organization, a man bombed by the government on May 13, 1985 in Philadelphia. This is what John Africa taught MOVE members. Just because it's legal, don't make it right. Remember, the Holocaust was legal. Slavery, one of the greatest crimes against humanity, was legal. The mass internment of Japanese Americans, according to the U.S. Supreme Court's Korematsu decision, was legal. All of this was legal. But was it right? To L4BL, let's fight for what's right. For freedom, not mass incarceration. For justice, not repression. Because black lives matter, all black lives matter. On the MOVE, long live John Africa. All power to the people. From Imprisoned Nation, this is Mumia Abu-Jamal.
According to police, Deadman, with two teenage girls as his passengers, drove to a local McDonald's meeting up with the rest of the group. There, according to witnesses interviewed by police, he said, "I ran that nigger over."
Thousands of pedestrians in the United States are killed each year in traffic accidents, and researchers have noticed that people of color are more likely than whites to be victims. To understand what might be happening here, we're joined by NPR social science correspondent Shankar Vedantam. Shankar, welcome back.
Hi, David.
So what is explaining this disparity?
Well, researchers have been trying to tease apart this question for quite some time, David. Why are people of color, as a proportion to their share of the population, more likely to be pedestrian fatalities in these car crashes? There are lots of possible explanations. One is that people of color are just more likely to be pedestrians, or it might be that minority neighborhoods have less safe traffic intersections. I was speaking with Courtney Koganauer. She's a public health researcher at the University of Nevada in Las Vegas. She told me she got interested in this question partly because of what she sees around her. We were talking in late December, and she told me how 2016 was shaping up in comparison to 2015 in terms of pedestrian fatalities in Las Vegas.
We have a really big problem with pedestrian injuries here. In fact, currently we are in an epidemic of pedestrian injuries in our city. Sadly, almost daily you hear about people being struck. Our numbers are currently up right now. I mean, we're almost at the end of the year, so by the end of the year this year, it's projected that we're going to well surpass the number of pedestrian fatalities that we had last year.
Okay, Shankar, so she sees this problem, a growing problem in the city of Las Vegas, and she decides to dig deeper.
That's right. She decides to conduct an experiment. It's really very simple, David. She wanted to see whether the race of pedestrians has any effect on the behavior of drivers in Las Vegas. Along with her co-authors, she had research assistants step into intersections at crosswalks while other researchers measured whether cars stopped for them. According to law, if you have a pedestrian in a crosswalk in your half of the road in Las Vegas, you're supposed to stop. Now, here's the real heart of the study, David. One of the pedestrians they had walking across these crosswalks was white, and the other one was black. Here's Koganauer on what they found.
Cars were less likely to yield to the African-American pedestrian when they were in the roadway compared to the white pedestrian. It was a significant difference.
So race did matter. I mean, are we able to conclude from this that drivers have some sort of bias here?
You know, I think it's fair to say that the study does show that there is a driver bias. We don't know whether that bias is conscious or unconscious. It seems like this might be one of the factors that could be driving the disparity in pedestrian fatalities across the United States. Obviously, this one study can't answer that question because even though there are thousands of pedestrian deaths every year, these incidents are still relatively rare. So you would need a very, very large study to detect a relationship between between driver bias and pedestrian fatalities. One of the interesting things that this study found, David, was that driver behavior was not uniform in all parts of the city. The researchers ran the experiment both in a high-income neighborhood and in a low-income neighborhood. They found, as other research by Dr. Keltner at the University of California has found, drivers in the rich neighborhood were less likely to stop for pedestrians than drivers in the poor neighborhood.
So a lot of factors could be at play here.
Potentially.
Okay. Thanks, Shankar, as always.
Thank you, David.
That is Shankar Vedantam. He is NPR social science correspondent, and he is the host of a podcast that explores the unseen patterns in human behavior. It's called Hidden Brain.
Support for Hidden Brain comes from Eli Lilly and Company. For 140 years, Lilly has been dedicated to uniting caring with discovery to make life better for people. Information on how the people of Lilly turn inspiration into action is at lillyforbetter.com.
You're listening to Morning Edition from NPR News. I'm David Greene.
And I'm Steve Inskeep.
Why haven't you learned anything?
North Carolina teachers have gotten some highly publicized pay raises over the past few years. Few objected to the moves, and many said they were long overdue. But there were more changes behind the scene, like the reduction of teaching assistant positions. That's probably reduced the number of minority faculty and staff. WUNC data reporter Jason DeBruin joins us to discuss the trend. Good morning, Jason.
Hi, Eric. Nice to be with you.
So we know North Carolina's population's growing, but you say there are fewer teaching assistants. Why is that?
Yeah, for years there was a steady increase in teacher assistants all throughout the early 2000s, but then after 2009 it took a bit of a decrease. So now we have only about 21,000 teacher assistants across the entire state, which is roughly a 30% decrease from the high point in 2009. This is happening because of budget cuts. You know, teachers are getting higher salaries, but that money has to come from somewhere. Unfortunately, teacher assistants is one of those positions that were cut.
What's it mean for students?
It's bad. You know, the students need that one-on-one interaction, and teacher assistants can provide that when a teacher is focused on a classroom as a whole. The TA can come with students that are falling behind. There's an education researcher, Helen Ladd from Duke University, who's done a lot of this kind of research, and she found that teaching assistants are beneficial, particularly to disadvantaged students, those with learning disabilities. So these students definitely need that one-on-one interaction more so than students without learning disabilities, and also students from racial minorities.
And why is that?
Well, minorities make up a larger percentage of teaching assistants than teachers. I'll give you some statistics. One out of only every five teachers is a minority, so four out of five are white, whereas one out of three teaching assistants are of a minority race. So you definitely have teaching assistants that tend to look more like the overall student body. And that's important. I talked to Matt Ellenwood, who directs the Education and Law Project with the North Carolina Justice Center, and he said it's important for students to see people who look like them and working in the system.
I think sometimes we underestimate the importance of seeing someone who's gotten to where you want to go, how powerful that can be to say, hey, if I can just do what Mr. Jones does that did, then I can get to where I need to go. And if you never have that person that you see who's done it, that can make it more difficult. There's clearly a value to diversity in general when it comes to education in terms of student outcomes, and I think that applies to the teaching force as well as to the student population.
We actually had a pretty good conversation. Later in the interview, we talked a little bit about cultural norms and even something as simple as like respect. Sometimes in one culture and one background, respect might come across as a little bit different. So if you have a student from one racial background who actually is showing a teacher respect just because that teacher comes from a different racial background, it might not be perceived that way. So when you have people of the same race, certainly same gender as well, in classrooms that more fit the background of the student body as a whole, that's just better overall for everybody.
Jason, thanks so much for coming in this morning.
Thanks so much for having me.
Jason DeBruin is WUNC's data reporter.
You want to save your money? Put it in your books. Because niggas don't read.
Many students aren't learning to read on an adult level, and that has a huge effect on success in school and at work. Drago Little teaches literature at Rainier Scholars. It's a college prep program for low-income students of color in Seattle. Little told KUW race and equity reporter Ann Dornfeld that there's a lot at stake for disadvantaged students and America.
2 years ago, the National Assessment of Educational Progress put out a summary report. According to that report, only 14% of all black American 12th graders are proficient readers. Now, if you think about proficiency on the NAEP, it does not mean that you read above grade level. It means you can make inferences at grade level. So what that could mean is that 85% of black American seniors in high school cannot read and understand the Constitution. That's a very serious problem.
And that's only looking at the black 12th graders who are still in school.
Right. Outside of maybe physical and psychological safety, I would say in a society like ours, literacy is probably the most important subject because it is the conduit through which all knowledge comes. Right now, there's a big move to have more STEM education, and that's extremely important as well. But you can't access the wonder and magic of science if you don't read well. And it kind of frustrates me to see all the STEM talk without some connection to literacy. And so for me, it was a way to empower people to understand the things that they needed to understand for themselves and to research things as they came up. And so I made a list of all my friends and all the ones who'd made it to college and sort of become successful, however you define that. They were all good readers.
For a struggling reader, like so many kids are, especially kids of color, what is school like as the years progress?
Everyone knows Pavlov from his research on dogs. But what Pavlov also did very good research on was on fostering aggression in especially young men. And he said there are three elements to that. He says you have to have something that needs to be done that is important, that is publicly visible, like reading in a class. You have to systematically deny the means by which to acquire that public thing that people are supposed to do. And then you have to systematically withhold the means to do that. And the way some kids learn how to read, that is exactly the problem. And so kids just reject it. They just back up from it. But when they're called out in class to do something they can't do and everyone's looking at them, and if you're talking about kids of color, many of them are already maligned in school in some ways, then it creates that feeling of shame and discomfort. And what we find in certain surveys and adult literacy research is that kind of never goes away. They just think reading is not for them.
What do you see that doing to the psyche of young people of color and older people of color?
My primary concern is that it keeps them from engaging in the society as full citizens. So there are all kinds of very basic things that highly literate people take for granted. My favorite example is the housing crisis. I would probably argue that if you surveyed the people who signed documents they didn't understand for loans that were probably going to sink them financially, if they had really understood those documents, then they probably wouldn't have signed them. And then the other thing I have seen is I have had a lot of people of color who are maybe mid-level professionals who feel sort of hobbled by their reading and writing skills. I get a lot of requests from people who, some of whom have gone to college, but still have fairly weak literacy skills and who are concerned about their literacy, both reading and writing. And if you think about the amount of email you have to send in a white-collar job, that would be a very nerve-wracking thing. The other big connection that I've become very interested in probably in the last 3 to 4 years is the connection between literacy and health. And there was a very important study done a few years ago that said, I think it was as many as 80 million adults have poor health outcomes because of their level of literacy. If you don't read well, you probably don't understand the doctor's instructions as well, because most doctors, even when they don't mean to, tend to speak in very elaborate medical vocabulary and language. And so it has the very real effect of making you less effective in addressing your own health needs. And so, I mean, the ripple effects of literacy are kind of everywhere, but that was probably one of the more important connections I made early on.
So teacher quality is obviously important. If kids got to see teachers who looked like them, who sounded like them, who talked about things that were relevant to them and lit up their interest in reading, would that be what it took?
So I would do three things. First is I would double the amount of time teachers spend in being training in schools, and I would reform some of the teacher training programs to actually deal with teaching kids, right? A lot of it can be a lot of useless theory. Two, I would make some effort to upgrade the teaching profession in this country. We don't talk about that. Teachers should make more money. They should be better supported, and we have not made the decision in this country to fully support public education. And three, it's important to have a diverse teaching profession. But in my opinion, it is just as important, especially in the humanities, which is my area, primarily literacy, to have teachers who know what human truth is and its connection to what we euphemistically refer to as relevant. My favorite example of that is Oliver Twist is more about kids in the hood than it is about kids in privileged neighborhoods in North Seattle. But because it's Dickens and because it has fancy vocabulary, we tend to think it is not about the kids of color in South Seattle. The Grapes of Wrath is more about low-income, exploited, disrespected immigrant families than it will ever be about privileged kids in AP. They are human truths that everyone should be exposed to. Their Eyes Were Watching God is about every woman on the planet Earth, because the idea in that book is what makes a good relationship. Every human being has to answer that question. So not that you don't want more teachers of color, I'm all for that, being one myself, but more importantly is you need teachers who can acknowledge and celebrate the deep human truths that exist in every culture.
With KUOW's Ann Dornfeld, that's Drago Little. He teaches humanities at Seattle University and literature at Rainier Scholars.
So how's the college responding to this incident?
We're having a race forum.
And what's that?
A forum on race, so we can discuss the incident and the surrounding issues of race.
So the usual lip service.
No comment. Good evening, I'm Amber Noggle.
I'm Greg Jeske, and tonight the student council at UW-Madison wants the university to make a big change to right what it says are past wrongs.
Members of the Associated Students of Madison are demanding free tuition for black students. ASM members say free tuition would serve as reparation for barring black people from education during slavery. The group says the school also remains out of reach for many students of color. Our own Hunter Sines caught up with the author of the resolution.
New at 10, why that student says this solution doesn't have to be the only one.
It's just a very small community of black students on this campus.
Tyreek Mack is a junior at UW-Madison. He's also the author of a resolution calling for all black students to be able to attend UW-Madison for free.
Who is this university benefiting? It's definitely not the black people of the state.
The reason for the idea stemming from blacks not being able to gain an education during slavery.
The idea that we live in this post-racial society is absurd.
Currently, black students only make up 2% of the student population at UW-Madison. The university releasing a response saying in part, quote, "We've increased enrollment of students of color and boosted financial aid for first generation and other underrepresented students."
They like to talk about all the efforts that they're making, but it's not enough.
The resolution is also calling on the UW administration to assess the test optional admissions policy and increase need-based financial aid. The university saying we will continue to partner with students on these efforts, but says it's unclear that the methods that they're suggesting are either legal or the best approach. But Mack admits his idea doesn't have to be the only one, urging others to step up.
Why is this the only solution? Where is your solution? That's what I got the question for the students who don't necessarily agree with this. Where is your...
The Associated Students of Madison passed this resolution with a 23-0 vote in favor of it, with only one not voting at all. Mack says if the chancellor doesn't meet their demands, students will organize to voice more concern. Greg?
All right, Hunter. Tyreek Mack also says the UW needs to do more to help reintegrate inmates to society by offering former black prisoners free tuition, too. That includes free housing and no fees, adding up to about $20,000 a year.
I was the first, one of the first. My first day was state trooper coming, putting me in the back seat of the car, and meeting the other black kids with six of us. And then seeing all of those parents and also KKK members having signs and throwing cans at us, spitting at us. We lived in the threat of death every day, every day. So I was just lost in this vacuum between integration and segregation and racism. That was my childhood. Oh, angry for years. Angry. Very angry.
Tonight, we investigate. He says his classmates took his dignity and then his school failed to act. A high school student says he was subjected to a long pattern of harassment because of the color of his skin.
And his parents tell us the district is now failing them. Investigative reporter Liz Wagner is with us. And Liz, what's happening here?
We found their claims are backed up by other students and a federal investigation. Tonight, the family is telling its story because a year and a half later, they feel like there's still no resolution.
As a kid, football meant everything to Evan Mack, and he couldn't wait to play at Sebastopol's Annaly High School.
I went to that school because it held this promise of making my life better.
But Mack says the school made his life worse.
All I got from the day I showed up on that campus was nothing but disappointment after disappointment after disappointment.
He says students made racist comments, teachers overlooked it, and administrators failed to act in a district where black and biracial students make up just 6% of the population. Mack says on the field, kids used racial slurs, and in class, they called him the N-word.
And I would say, could we please not do that?
Around campus, he noticed the Confederate flag on clothing and cars. A former classmate posted this picture on social media. And in the locker room, he says he once overheard some teammates singing this David Allen Coe song. He tells us the language happened within earshot of school staff, but no one intervened.
It was the kind of thing that you didn't talk about, for one. Or if that you did talk about it, that no one really even cared.
Mack kept quiet for 2 years until he showed his parents these online exchanges with two students.
Just because you're an and think like that doesn't mean I do, and I will punch you in the thing mouth.
Raquel and John Mack brought the threats to the West Sonoma County Union High School District. Officials spoke with the students and, according to this letter, warned one of them about any continued harassment. The other left the school. They discussed with the coach ways to ensure all players feel supported. Then, the principal closed the case.
How would you describe the school's investigation?
There wasn't one.
No, there was no investigation.
So, the Mack sent a complaint to the U.S. Department of Education's Office for Civil Rights here in San Francisco. It investigated and last fall issued this 20-page report noting the district's failure to follow its own grievance procedures and finding its investigation was not appropriate.
It amounted to a civil rights violation. The district didn't admit any wrongdoing, but agreed to make changes, create an anti-harassment statement, provide training, and conduct climate surveys about race. The district told the feds the climate for African-American students was welcoming and friendly.
They're like, they would say the N-word all the time.
But these kids say they felt like outsiders.
Like, they tried to call Evan Mack's situation like a singular situation and say that it was just him. It is not just him. They treat other kids of color like that.
Do you feel like administrators at your former high school had your back?
No, not at all.
When their parents pulled them from Annaly, they say school leaders never followed up.
What does that say to you?
That they didn't care.
We wanted to ask the district why it took a federal investigation for Annaly to confront an apparent racial divide. Officials declined an interview request, citing a lawsuit the Mack family filed last month. The superintendent tells us he's following the federal agreement, writing the district takes these matters very seriously and strives to provide an environment free of harassment and discrimination for everyone.
There needs to be a mutual culture of respect.
Evan Mack will graduate from a new high school this year, but his parents want accountability for all students in his former district. A district in a city where people want to get rid of racism, not promote it.
The Department of Education's findings here signal serious action, and it doesn't happen often. Last year, the feds received nearly 2,500 racial discrimination complaints. They found violations and resolved just 57 cases nationally, 17 in California. Guys.
Okay, Liz, thank you.
We do not know whether the killer of Reverend Pinckney and eight others knew all of this history. But he surely sensed the meaning of his violent act. It was an act that drew on a long history of bombs and arson and shots fired at churches. Not random, but as a means of control, a way to terrorize and oppress. An act that he imagined would incite fear and recrimination, violence and suspicion. An act that he presumed would deepen divisions that trace back to our nation's original sin. Oh, but God works in mysterious ways.
I've seen what Dylann Roof did, and in my heart, I reckon I got a little bit of hatred, and I want to do that. Words of this man, now in jail facing federal charges, how the FBI tracked down the man investigators say wanted to pull off a Roof-style attack. Well, this is a story WMBF News broke this morning. We were the first to tell you about 29-year-old Benjamin McDowell's arrest and the only station inside the federal courtroom where he went before a judge this morning. Lisa Gresci is live in Myrtle Beach with the very latest on this disturbing investigation. Lisa?
Christelle, I'm live here at the Temple Emmanuel Synagogue off of 65th Avenue, North and Business 17, a location Benjamin or Benji McDowell mentioned in the Facebook message that caught the attention of investigators. An affidavit detailing what led to his arrest notes the FBI had its eyes on McDowell over the last several months and made undercover contact with him, watching everything from radical Facebook posts and messages to his efforts to purchase a gun and ammunition. In the post, the FBI says McDowell made, you can see, pledged allegiance to white supremacy groups and Dylann Roof, while also calling out those groups for not following in Roof's footsteps. In one alleged post, he said, quote, if you ain't got the heart to fight for Yahweh like Dylann Roof did, you need to shut the expletive up. Another focuses on his plan, saying, quote, I just be plotting it out, like I mean just run up there on them if they back their partying and all with an expletive AK-47 and rip them expletive down. In a Facebook message, he mentioned Temple Emmanuel by name, but reportedly told an officer he had not decided on a place or time to carry out an attack. The FBI caught up with McDowell at the Hampton Inn at Broadway at the beach yesterday, where investigators say they found a gun and ammunition. Because McDowell is a convicted felon with a lengthy criminal record in Horry County, he has been federally charged, but with having a firearm or ammunition by a prohibited person. This morning, McDowell went before a judge at the federal courthouse in Florence, where in that courtroom, where he said he did understand he is to be back in court February 21st. Until then, he's being held at the Florence County Detention Center. Reporting live here in Myrtle Beach, Lisa Gresci, WMBF News.
Thank you so much, Lisa. And prior to today's arrest, Facebook was a vehicle for Benjamin McDowell's to voice his white supremacy extremist ideas, indicating in one post he wanted to be a white warrior like we were, quote, born to be. In the confession video released by the government, convicted Emmanuel shooter Dylann Roof expressed similar views, saying, quote, white people are superior. Roof was sentenced to death last month and is currently awaiting a state trial where he also faces the death penalty if convicted. And federal documents show several other chilling statements from McDowell referencing Dylann Roof a total of five times and saying other white supremacists weren't getting the job done. For a full breakdown of this document, you can head to WMBFnews.com and find this story. McDowell will be back in court on February 21st.
Context of White Supremacy, Gus T. Renegade in for another broadcast, hopefully to share constructive information on the system of white supremacy. Today's date, Saturday, February 18th, 2017, so I have been told. Compensatory call-in every Saturday, same time, 9 p.m. Eastern, 6 p.m. Pacific. Looking forward to hearing from non-white people, victims of racism, your views, observations, thoughts on things that have taken place over the last 7 days. If you have counter-racist suggestions, feel free, dial in the number 641-715-3640. The code 564-9400. #343#. Press *6 if you would like to participate. That number again, 641-715-3640. The code is 564-943#. Press *6 if you would like to participate. We are listener-supported, counter-racist radio. Invest if you think the program is constructive. racism-notes.blogspot.com, racism-notes.blogspot.com. When you hit the website, look on the right side of the page. You'll see our PayPal button. If you're not in the PayPal, drop us an email. We will get you a physical mailing address. Huge thanks to all the folks who have supported Days Away from our 8-year anniversary. Hope the program has helped some non-white people, victims of racism, get a better understanding of what white supremacy racism is and how it works. Constructive investment of your time and energy. We have too many problems. Certainly, if you're not getting great, valuable information from the cows, then find something else to do with your time. Right on. A couple things we wanted to touch on before we get to callers. Number one, Sabrina Johnson. Folks remember she was a guest on the program last year. She called in when we had Lauren Kresslove, Dr. Welsing's sister, on the program. She's worked with Dr. Welsing for a number of years. They are right now looking at holding a commemoration and call to action in honor of Dr. Welsing. There will also be a birthday tribute to her. They are contemplating fundraising for the event. Just looking right now, Saturday, March 18th at 7 p.m. Eastern at the Thurgood Marshall Center in Washington, D.C. Again, that's Saturday, March 18th at 7 p.m. Eastern. So for folks who are in the Washington, D.C. area, or if you would be inclined to take a trip that area for March 18th, you can get in contact with Ms. Sabrina Johnson. Her email is sabrinajohnson27@earthlink.net. sabrinajohnson27@earthlink.net. Drop her a line if you need any more details, information, what have you. March 18th tribute to Dr. Welsing. Next, we had a listener who asked if I was going to see the documentary on James Baldwin, I Am Not Your Negro. I'm a fan of James Baldwin. I've read quite a bit of his work. I need to read more. But I saw information about the film some months back, and my interest was piqued. I will say that I have seen whites talking about this film in glorious terms, and whites often do talk about James Baldwin in glorious terms, and they'll cherry pick different, you know, items, comments that he made about racism, white supremacy down through the years. I am interested. I'll check it out. I kind of have the same view as I do about I think Mr. Peele, he's doing the film that's coming out in a couple of days, Get Out. It's supposed to be about racism. It's kind of a horror flick satire thing. This one of our listeners, she said that a lot of white people seem really, really elated about this film and just really, really anxious to go see it, and lots of praise. And she said anything that white people get excited about like that, I get suspicious. That's the same position that I take. So I kind of have that thought in mind also about this James Baldwin documentary. But I am probably going to check it out down the road. Just, you know, I'm not overly excited about it. Next, I think right now, I was going to say one thing I will have to do, I might even do it today, but just do the roll call of all of the books that we've read over the 5-year period. The program is about to do our 8-year anniversary, but the book club is 5 years old. To just list all of the books that we've read in the book club, it is an impressive list. That's, you know, it's no bragging on the slave ship, but I think anybody, any non-white person in the world, because we haven't just read authors, U.S. authors, any non-white person in the world If you even read half of the books, I'm not even saying that you have to go back and listen to the archives of the book study session, but if you even read half of the books that we've covered in the Cows Book Club, I think you will substantially increase your understanding of what racism, white supremacy is, how it works, what it means to be classified as white. In that vein, I was thinking, based on one of the audio clips that you heard and based on one of the last conversations that I had with Dr. Francis Kress-Welsing that was not on a program, we talked about The Man in the High Castle, and she asked for the book because I told her about this series, and I told her that this was based on a book that was published in the 1960s, a sci-fi series, I think it is, series of books. And I gave her the author and everything, and she was like, wow, I want to read this. You should read this. Reading is more important than watching television. In that spirit, I would like to do The Man in the High Castle as the next book for the Cows Book Club. I think we still have about four sessions at minimum to go on The Delectable Negro, so we're not close to being done. But just in advance, unless people have something much more important or substantial, I think that should be the next book that we do. I think I've heard quite a few listeners comment that they really enjoy the series and are watching it, and you know, think it reveals a lot about racism, white supremacy, particularly for a series like that that postulates a history where the Nazis won World War II and now occupy North America. To have a series like that in this time period, very interesting, but I think that'll be the next book we do for the book club. Next, Henrietta, speaking of the book club, one of the books that we read, The Immortal Life of Henrietta Lacks by Rebecca Skloot. This is a suspected race soldier, white woman, who wrote the book. I think we read Henrietta Lacks, I think that was at the end of 2014, because it was at the time of the quote-unquote Ebola crisis, where they were talking about then it wasn't a Muslim ban, it was a Negro ban. They didn't want any black people from the continent coming over here and infecting everybody with Ebola or anything else. And we read Rebecca Skloot's Immortal Life of Henrietta Lacks, lots of another example of racism, white supremacy in the medical industry just this week. If you participated with the book club or if you've read the book just this week, Henrietta Lacks' family wants compensation for her cells. I'm reading from the Washington Post. This was posted on Valentine's Day, so they tell me, February 14th. The eldest son of Henrietta Lacks wants compensation from John Hopkins University and possibly others for the unauthorized use of her cells in research that led to decades of medical advances. Lawrence Lacks said that he is the executor of his mother's estate and that an agreement that the National Institutes of Health made with other family members over the years regarding the use of the cells was not valid. That agreement did not include compensation. The cells were taken from the 31-year-old from Turner's Station, Maryland, who had an aggressive form of cervical cancer in 1951. They were the first cells to live outside the body in a glass tube. They were dubbed the HeLa cells and have become the most widely used human cells that exist in scientific research. Vaccines, cancer treatments, and in vitro fertilization are among the many medical techniques derived from her cells. My mother would be so proud that her cells saved lives, Lawrence Lacks said in a statement. She'd be horrified that John Hopkins profited while her family, to this day, has no rights. Hopkins officials said in a statement that when the cells were taken, there was no established practice for informing or obtaining consent from cell or tissue donors. Even that word is interesting because she was not a quote-unquote donor. She was a victim of theft, but nor were there any regulations on the use of cells in research. Today, John Hopkins and other medical research centers maintain strict patient consent processes for tissue and cell donation. The statement said it is now standard practice to have an institutional review board examine every research study involving human participants before it is allowed to begin. The medical institution said it hasn't profited from the cells. John Hopkins never patented HeLa cells and therefore does not own the rights to the HeLa cell line, the statement said. John Hopkins also did not sell or profit from the discovery or distribution of HeLa cells. The National Institute of Health came to an agreement in 2013 with some of Lacks' family that required scientists to get permission from the government agency to use her genetic blueprint. The agreement also required researchers who get NIH funding to use a database of Lacks' genome that they can only access by applying through the federal agency. One of her grandsons and a great-granddaughter were appointed to a working group to help make the decisions. But Lawrence Lacks, 82, said he never signed off on that agreement. When he asked NIH for more information, he said it cut him out of the process. "I really didn't understand what was going on," Lacks said. "Instead of explaining it to me, they went three generations under me." An NIH representative said the agency could not respond to a request for comment Monday. Lawrence Lacks and his son and daughter-in-law said in an interview that they plan to file a lawsuit against Hopkins in coming weeks. The family members said they had contacted other attorneys in the past but were told they had passed the statute of limitations. Francis Lanasa, the attorney who will represent the family, said that he would use a continuing tort argument alleging that Hopkins had continued to violate the personal rights, privacy, and body parts of Henrietta Lacks over time. "They are literally the foundation of modern medical science," Lanasa said of the cells. Lawrence Lacks, a retired Amtrak engineer, said he remembers when Hopkins' doctors came and asked his family for blood samples in the 1970s. They gave the samples not knowing they were being used to research the HeLa cells. We talked about that in the book. Ms. Glute does talk about that. The family, they were deliberately deceived to steal more of their genetic material. But Ron Lacks, Lawrence Lacks' son, said pharmaceutical companies, authors, hospitals, and scores of other institutions have made money off of his grandmother's cells, including Rebecca Skloot. The family has even seen artwork made of pictures of her cells for sale on the internet. "Everyone else is making funds off of Henrietta's cells," Ron Lacks said. "I'm sure my grandmother is up in heaven saying, well, what about my family?" The family said they want her cells to be owned by her estate and they would set up a foundation to allow everyone to benefit from the cells. Hopkins officials said they have worked with the family members to develop programs to recognize and honor Lacks, including scholarships, annual symposia, and a historical exhibit on the Hopkins Medical Campus. The family said that is not enough to correct the wrong done to Lacks. "We have been living with this for years," Ron Lacks said. "It is getting to the point where it is the principle of everything." This was taken, this was published in the Washington Post, but this was originally in the Baltimore Sun. Henrietta Lacks' family wants compensation for her cells. Just more examples. I don't even recall if this is included in medical apartheid. I'd have to go back and double check. If I had to wager, I would say it probably wasn't, because Rebecca Skloot's book was not published at the time that medical apartheid was released. Not that, you know, that's the only bit of information that's ever been out about Henrietta Lacks or what have you, but that book certainly provided more of a spotlight, more information, more attention on the Lacks case. But yeah, I have to go back and check, because I don't think Henrietta Lacks is in Harriet Washington's first book. With that said, we will go ahead and get to the callers. Remind folks again, if you could take 5 minutes or less to share your comments. That way we make sure everybody gets at least one opportunity to share. And then if we have additional time, folks can make their second or third comments, questions, observations. Also for today, if we could refrain from using metaphors, that would be super appreciated. I think frequently in the system of white supremacy, white people, they employ metaphors deliberately to be deceptive. They will make comparisons, analogies, similes, where they are comparing two things that are not equivalent. They do this sort of thing all the time, and it just generates confusion, so you don't get an accurate understanding of what's happening. Non-white people, I think the bulk of victims, a lot of times we're still learning, we're still trying to come to a conclusion on our views, counter racism, racism, what to do. And a lot of times I think we will use a metaphor to try to convey our thoughts and thinking that, you know, people will understand what it is we're trying to articulate. And that's not the case at all. Really, when we're talking about racism, we want to make sure that we are being explicit, clear, so that people can understand exactly, precisely what it is we are saying. In that, in that effort, if we could not use metaphors for this broadcast, that would be greatly appreciated, and I will prompt about that. If also you could watch the background noise, we'd appreciate that also. If you know you're in a loud environment, just use your mute button, and then whenever you want to talk, you can unmute yourself, get your comment in, and then you can mute again. That way it just helps preserve the quality of the program and don't have other people having to struggle and fight over a lot of extra background noise. With that, we will get to the phone lines. The first few people who dialed in who have a hand up, line should be open. Proceed.
Yes, may I be heard?
May I be heard?
Yes, sir.
Okay, greetings, Gus, and to the rest of the callers. So, me personally, I love science. I'm very interested in science, especially biology-related science. And just hearing the first audio, when I heard the term genetically modified embryos, I just thought to myself, whoa, I have not heard of that before. And I've heard of things similar to that, like genetically modified foods and genetically mutated humans. And I found it pretty interesting because just from what I heard, it's not, you can't really extract sperm in an egg to edit the genetic material made for an embryo just for now, but later on people are planning on doing it. Just for now, we can't really do it. And I want to see the results of that. I want to see how that would look, because I haven't really seen it before. I've seen albinism, and that's like genetic mutation, but I don't think I've seen genetic modification before, and I'm just very interested in seeing that, and I'm very interested in researching it because it sounds like an interesting topic that'll probably benefit me in the future. And yeah, so genetically modified embryos is a new term that I have not heard of and has not been taught at my school yet, and it's just, I find it very interesting for now. I'm gonna look it up and see what I get. Because, like I said before, I'm very interested in science, and I feel like I'm going to continue my career as a scientist in the field of biology or computer science. It's just because I like examining the human body and just knowing where I came from. Because I've heard that science is religion, and religion is religious thinking, according to Phil Valentine. And that's one of the things that got me interested in science. And yeah, I hope to prosper that term and find out what it means so that I'll have a better understanding of it. But yeah, that's all I wanted to share. Thank you for taking my call.
That's grand. Always to be curious, to try to learn more about the world, more about yourself. That's outstanding. Let us know what you find. Before you depart, I did want to ask really quick, did you hear anything about the incident with Evan Mack? This is the teenager in California who was at Annalee High School, where he was being tormented and called a nigger and everything else. Had you heard anything about that?
I have not heard of that yet, but yeah, I'll look that up as well.
Right on. Other folks who dialed in who have a hand up should be with us, and no speakerphone as well for other folks. Thank you so much, our young scholar in the Bay Area. Always good to hear from you, sir. Other folks that we have not heard from. Oh, yeah. It sounds like we still have some people who are using speakerphone. The caller at 4683. I don't know if you're listening to the program in the background or if you're on speakerphone or something, but it's echoing. So if you can get that taken care of, that would be great. Other folks that we have not heard from.
May I be heard?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, greetings to everyone on the line. About the clip, that clip you played with the female being interviewed and talking about racism in Canada, do you know if that was a white female or not, like you?
I'm not sure. She said that she had non-white children. They did not have an image of her, but I am not sure. I'll have to look.
Yeah, I didn't even catch her name, so I didn't know if it was like some type of well-known person in Canada or not. But yeah, I did hear her say constantly with children of color, quote unquote. But yeah, you can find that one now. Secondly, it's interesting. There are no coincidences. I was listening earlier this week to the program with Cisco Street Love on Whitney Houston, so it was really interesting to hear. I did not watch the Grammy. It was really interesting to hear the situation with Adele and Beyonce. Anyone who hasn't heard that particular program, I would suggest you go back and listen to it. It's informative. And lastly, for the clip, the clip about the man in the high castle, I just think that like described exactly what is meant by refinement. They kept saying how all these incidences of so-called white nationalist groups and the reference to internment camps and the whole entire Trump administration doesn't look exactly like how the Nazis looked or anything like that, but just the fact they had to keep saying, yeah, it doesn't look exactly like it, but it looks kind of like it. I just thought that was the definition of refinement. And lastly, Gus, I can't remember, is area number 3 off the table for the compensatory call-in?
It depends on what it is.
Okay. I saw Birth of a Nation this week, or the Sea Garden, the last of the Nation, when I was just going to say, yeah. I was just going to say, I forgot how much movies pull on your emotions. And, like, watching that, it just, like, messed up. Actually, I watched it Thursday, yeah. So watching that, it just, like, affected me the rest of the day emotionally. So I would have to go back and watch it again. So watch it with, like, more of an analytical mind. But this kind of throwing that out to the listeners, not that anyone who listens to the calamities may remind it necessarily, but yeah, just definitely be careful with that, like any type of consumption of entertainment. Try to keep context at the front of your mind at all times, because otherwise you can get really wrapped up in it, and it has a really, really serious effect on this. But yeah, I think that's it for everything I had to comment on. I will meet that line. Thank you.
The female that was speaking from Canada, Samantha Kemp Jackson, she is a black female.
Okay. Yeah. Thank you.
Did that clarify anything about her comments, or you were just curious?
I was mainly just curious talking about Canada. Yeah, I didn't really clarify much, but yeah, thank you.
For sure. Other folks that we have not heard from? Oh, yeah. Still got
to be heard?
Yes.
Hello. Greetings to everyone. I had, I guess, just two observations. The first one about one of the clips about the study that they're doing or that they have done in Nevada about the pedestrians and being the likelihood of a non-white person being hit. I've actually lived in Vegas for several years, and I had lived in Vegas for several years, and I could definitely tell you that that's something that I've actually witnessed, and this was several years back, but there was like a bus stop that I used to walk by all the time, and one day a white lady drove onto the bus stop and killed a black pregnant lady, and a non-white male. He might have been biracial, not quite sure, but they end up actually not giving her any jail time, any type of punishment, any punitive actions at all. They just basically said, well, she was just off her medication. And so it's not even necessarily that you have to be a pedestrian. People have driven up on the sidewalk and hit people, and it just doesn't go anywhere. And then also there was another guy that was a family friend, and he had just went out there, probably was out there for a couple of days, a black male, and he was hit. So it's definitely something that I have witnessed, and it's definitely actually affected my life. If I were to ever cross the street, I'd definitely make sure, double check, triple check, just because of having to be out there and just being, just observing that. The other observation, I was actually the one who wrote in last week about the issue with the dental technician and how I just didn't really feel comfortable with her setting the tools on my chest and taking them back off and what have you. Well, I had called the office, spoke to the office manager, which I felt was likely a white female, like extremely curt with me, and basically kept asking her, you know, that doesn't seem hygienic, and also it doesn't seem professional. To just use someone's bib or i.e. chest as like a tray instead of actually just having a tray. But that basically didn't make any difference to them. And I also asked, well, men can do that too. And yes, it doesn't matter if we don't have, and basically what she said, well, you know, if we don't have the help to, if we don't have like a dental assistant to help the technician, then we're just basically can set it anywhere. She didn't say can set it anywhere, but that, like I said, she's definitely very rude. I called back because after that exchange, she basically hung up. I had to call back and say, you know, cancel all my appointments because it just didn't seem, you know, hygienic as well. And when I called back, I had to speak to another white lady who was like, oh, so that's your problem. So it's definitely like, sometimes I feel like with white females, because I feel like I seem to have more issues with white females than white women and white men. So I just wanted to add that. And I'm also in the process of filing a complaint with the State Board of Dentists just to at least kind of get something started, because it seems like no one really seems that that's like an issue, at least on the hygienic side of it. But that's all I had to add this week. Thank you. I'll mute myself.
Good job following up both with the phone call and then following a report. I think that's something. Dr. Cambon and others would recommend to make sure that we comment, report rather, make a written record same way that they do with us. With that report about the vehicles, if you have a good memory, Dr. Welsing, she was on the program in 2014. They did a study, not in Las Vegas, but in Oregon, right down the road from me. And they found that it took black pedestrians almost 40% longer to cross the road. This was in Oregon. This was 2014 when they said that, oh, you know, we would need more studies and whatever. They have done these studies for years. I was talking to Dr. Welsing off the air, and then she brought it up on the air. I ended up faxing her this report about the study in Portland. I tried to see if we could get the authors of the study on the program, and she said that they had this campaign in D.C. where they were trying to get people to bike or walk, 'cause they have really bad traffic in the D.C. area. And she said, man, black people get hit. Like, I think she even said that there might have been a study or something that showed that black people were more likely to be, black bikers or whatever, were more likely to be hit there. But that they weren't even getting to the full depths of the racism, white supremacy. In fact, there are racist jokes. I was struggling. I was really pleased with the audio clip that I used to lead into that. Unfortunately, the murder of James Craig Anderson, where Daryl Dedman, white teenager in Mississippi, 2011, he and a group of his white racist friends beat up James Craig Anderson, ran him over, and bragged about killing, ran that nigger over. I was glad to find that. But their racist jokes, where they
brag about hitting black people in the road. Like, you get, you know, 5,000 points if you hit that nigger, 50 points if you hit that jig. I mean, they brag about this sort of thing all the time. I feel like they just, they gave a very superficial analysis in that report about black people and road safety. Other folks that we have not heard from?
Can I be heard?
Yes, ma'am.
Greetings, everybody. This is Amy. I felt the same way about the pedestrian clip. But also with that, everybody is using us as some kind of like case study thing and creating like layers upon layers of an unnecessary convoluted analysis that doesn't lead to any, like, to anything. And the truth is, like, we already know this. And so I kind of got a little frustrated in listening to it because, these college kids who just go around making up stuff, it's just very frustrating for me because they're using us all the time to do it. Like she was a genius for realizing that more black people are getting hit. Like, all you have to know is that nobody likes black people. So in every area of life, every area of everything, black people are always suffering no matter what it is. Like, we're always going to get shot more, ran over more, disrespected more, not given refund. I mean, like, you could do as many studies as you want to. The point is, that's what racism is. People try to make it seem like there's some difference between institutional racism and what they like to call implicit bias. That doesn't make up any sense. Individual people make up communities, make up institutions, make up agencies, make up organizations. So, like, I'm tired of it because it's like it conditions, I feel like this type of thing conditions black people to be always needing some kind of thing to understand that we're just black. And that's what it means to be black in a system of racism, white supremacy. But also, like, tears came to my eyes in the literacy clip because I'm very sensitive about that. It was a really rough week for me to be black. Let me just put that out there. And to know that our literacy rates are even dropping. I'm a pharmacy tech. I don't work like that now, but I used to. And when I first went to the city where I went to school and I was working in the pharmacy, I began realizing, I was like, why are all these black people upset? Like, I would be, like, ringing up the prescription. I'd be like, well, if you could read and sign that. And it was the HIPAA policy. If you could read and sign, acknowledge that. I've given you the HIPAA policy, whatever. And they would get real mad, like, what's that? You know, and it took me about a month to realize that they were mad because they couldn't read it. And if they read it, they couldn't understand it. Because it's one thing to be able to read something. It's another thing to be able to comprehend it. And so that's when I developed like a new way of saying it. This pretty much says, and then I had like a whole little spiel. And then it completely went away. But my asking them to read it. And it's like, that's a whole nother level of victimization to be unable to comprehend things. And I'm glad that they mentioned what it does in the medical field because we're being used there too. And you could give someone a monograph of a prescription. They can't read it and understand it. So they don't really understand the side effects, the like contradictions between the other medication, what's going to happen if they do it. No one likes black people. So black people are not going to receive any kind of good healthcare whatsoever at the pharmacy level, at the doctor level, like at any level. So we're just being pumped up with medication and just not like having any type of real health. The thing about, I was very frustrated, like, I think the previous female caller, one of the female callers, mentioned that it was, like, refinement when talking about the man in the high castle. I agree, like stop all of that. There's nothing ingenious or fantastic about what's being said. This is racism. They're ready to move into the next phase. What that next phase is going to look like is the only thing that I really want to know. Are we going to do the internment camps, or is it just going to be vigilante people shooting up black people, or a combination of the two? Like, what's up? And so that is kind of the thing that, you know, stuck out to me in some of the clips. And then for the teacher's assistants, that too also is really, really sad because it is important to be able to see yourself teach, you know, being a teacher. And I felt the same way. Like, that was the only thing that really pushed me to even go back to school was when I was like, I made up in my mind that, no, I can totally be good at math and be good at science whether I see a lot of black mathematicians or scientists in my face right now. And so we've just been victimized so much that it's terrible. If there's time later, I can chime on other stuff. But I just wanted to say that about the literacy, that it's just further victimization. Thank you.
Can I be heard?
Can I be heard?
Heard both of you. Let's get the female caller first.
Hi, I just want to touch on a special that I saw on C-SPAN 2. It was Timothy Tyson, the author of The Blood of Emmett Till. I actually emailed you the link. It was about an hour long. It appeared to be set up like a book signing, and there were people in the audience, and there was a Q&A session as well, which we had some, you couldn't see everybody, but it sounded like it was mostly white people in the audience, and there were a couple of black people that they actually asked good questions. So I wanted to share that, and also you can see the type of person that Timothy Tyson is. He was doing a lot of laughing and joking, and he was actually promoting his book, which I would think he would be more serious with it. But at one point he started crying. And then a few minutes after that, he was back to his jokes. So it was very interesting. And I just wanted to speak on that. That was it. Thanks.
Not the weeping white man. Gee whiz. Gee whiz. Mr. Steele, thank you for your patience. Did you want to go?
Yeah, sure. I just wanted to say that, one thing that I've noticed this week, with suspected white supremacists is that, liberalism and liberal ideas are being used as a means to, I don't know if this is a metaphor, but in a backhanded way or in a very deceptive manner of practicing white supremacy. This week, one character, Milo Yiannopoulos, who has been in the news, was featured on a show hosted by a self-described liberal comedian named Bill Maher. And on this program, one of the panelists dropped out in protest of him having this character on his program. And one of the reasons for giving this person a platform that I hear frequently espoused by self-described liberals who are practicing racism is that we have to give these people, racists, a chance to speak and to hear their ideas and then decide if their ideas are good or bad. And this has to be done in the public sphere, and this has to be done as publicly and as intellectually as possible. And one thing that I've noticed that the racists have taken advantage of with this mindset is that they don't really care about being intellectual. They just care about being on the platform. They've realized that the power of the platform outweighs the power of the substance of the debate that's taking place. So instead of a meaningful conversation, they just want to get on all of these platforms to espouse their nonsense and then other people to be entertained by it and to become so-called fans, and then they will become, in effect, supporters of white supremacy. The same logic was used by a white supremacist on YouTube by the name of PewDiePie. I'm beginning to understand that this person has one of the largest, or if not the largest, platform on On YouTube, he has the highest number of subscribers, many of whom are children, and he uses his platform to make a series of racist statements that he describes as jokes and just trolling and entertainment. Truth be told, it's in my opinion that this mindset to allow these people to put their ideas out there and to give these people a platform is only to support them. That's the way that it translates. As we're in a system of white supremacy, even the most crude and seemingly unintelligible ideas will be attractive and appealing to a number of people. And this number of people, I feel, is growing to a critical mass to where they are going to be A-okay with approving some of the more unrefined, I guess, examples and more deadly examples of white supremacy to be practiced on a wide scale and in public. So anytime you hear a suspected white supremacist ask you questions like, hey, why do you think something, insert something that is blatantly racist, here is racist, they're practicing a form of white supremacy. Anytime you say, you hear a white supremacist say, hey, how about we give this person who is a suspected Nazi a platform to speak, to hear his ideas out and to see if they're any good, anytime you hear that, you're probably dealing with a white supremacist or somebody who sympathizes with white supremacy. And I just urge all victims to be very wary of such speech. Bear in mind that the very liberal and permissive Weimar Republic was the fostered the environment with which Nazis were able to amass support and become the regime that would kick off and fight in World War II and commit the Holocaust against the Jewish population that they declared non-white. And I guess with that, I'll mute my line for now. Thank you so much.
Hello?
Yes, sir.
Oh, hey. Good evening. Good evening, everybody. I was just only able to listen to, like, the last 5 minutes of the clips, but the Henrietta Lacks story, you know, is just really tragic and just outright horrible. I mean, the idea that white people of various facilities can just make money off this woman, you know, off this dead woman, and then her family not be compensated. But then you have the idea that, okay, we'll work out something like scholarships. Now these scholarships will probably be geared for black people only, which will be okay, but it doesn't deal with the fact that her direct family should be compensated, and that's the only thing that matters. So, unless her family is directly compensated, everything else is important to me. Now, did y'all discuss the Robert Realmo case, the white police officer in Chicago who killed two people in one day and then tried and then sued the family? This happened, I believe, in around Christmas 2015.
I think we've talked about it before. I think Beth Smith is a black female. I think she was one of the victims. I think it was also a black male victim as well. I think we talked about it before where he said, the officer, where he said he had some sort of emotional problems or mental health anguish around this incident, and people accusing him of saying all these nasty things about him after he went out and did his job, and, you know, these two black people just happened to die. We have talked about it before. I don't think we've talked. We certainly haven't talked about it today.
Last Friday, no surprise, no indictment was given to him, no charges filed. He killed two black people, got away with it. Now what is more interesting is that the Illinois District Attorney needed 13 and a half months to complete this investigation and to state that no charges would be filed. Now, as I pointed out the last time I called this program, people from the Illinois District Attorney's Office only needed 16 days to complete investigation and indict black cop Lowell Hauser for killing his neighbor. You know, none of that, we can't rush to judgment in this case. No, just got him real quickly and with the top count on it as well. Oh, and also Lowell Hauser has a GoFundMe page. Goal's $100,000. To this day, he's only received $10. We all know what white cops like Dan Wilson, Daniel Holzclaw, and others get. For him, he only got $10. Also, this month, Illinois District Attorney, there was another police shooting. A Amtrak police officer. His name was Leroy Tompkins. He's black. The man he shot, I believe his name is Sean Thompson or Scott Thompson. He's black. Now, that shooting happened February 7th. The black police officer, Tompkins, goes, turns himself in for questioning. And 9 days later, he is given a first-degree murder indictment. 9 days, not 9 months, not 9 years, 99 weeks, 9 days. And what's interesting is this is an Amtrak police officer, which means he's a federal police officer. Yet, no federal prosecutor is claiming jurisdictional claim that we have to prosecute him. It's like they can have him.
Oh, is that all? I think M1 might have gotten disconnected. If he dials back in, we'll get the remainder of his commentary. Other folks that we have not heard from at all while we... Oh, yeah. The caller...
Can I be heard?
Yes, sir. Hello? Ross, we can hear you.
Oh, greetings back. And to the other callers and listeners, I wanted to start off by saying rest in peace to Clyde Stubblefield. He was James Brown's drummer. He's most well known for the funky drummer and that world-renowned drum loop that has been used in hip-hop ad infinitum, and he just passed away. I believe it was today at 73 years old. Another murder victim of the system of white supremacy, in my opinion. They said he died of kidney failure, but everything fails in a system of white supremacy as far as the black body is concerned, or the possibility of that is very high. So I just wanted to say rest in peace to him. The man in the high castle, I find that to be a very telling clip, and I think that is a great book for us to read next, just in honor of the supreme being of Black self-respect, Dr. Welsing. Just wanted to lift her up. And the interesting part about that, in my opinion, is that the Nazis did win in World War II. It was just a different group of Nazis, and we're seeing the results of it in the America that we live in. Because all white people are racist, that's my opinion. There's no such thing as a racist suspect, in my opinion. Every last one of them are racist, from fetus to the elderly. And the history of the Britons, the British people, is actually that they're descended from Germans, the Jutes. The Jutes were the group from Germany that they descended from. Them, the Scots, the Irish, the French, they're all the same people. They just moved to different parts of Europe, eventually different parts around the world practicing racism. So, yes, the Nazis did win, and we're seeing it right now, and it's culminating in the Donald Trump presidency. I also wanted to just big up Mr. Lawrence Lacks and the Lacks family, just for Black self-respect, as far as trying to get some sort of justice in regards to the horrible disservice that has been done to their ancestor. And it just goes to show, again, the value of the Black body and how white people will commodify the Black body to infinity, which is what they're doing with her, since her cells are basically indestructible. And this should give us a great insight into what all of us have to look forward to, especially if any of us show any signs of genetic prowess that they can use to further their own survival or just further mistreat Black people. The clip about race and crossing the street and that whole discussion I found fascinating, because coming from New York City, that is something that I'm very familiar with as well. There was a very well-known story of a white female in Queens. Matter of fact, Queens Boulevard is notorious for people getting hit and killed. And this woman actually hit someone. She was drunk driving. She was driving an SUV, hit a Black male, impaled him in her windshield, drove home with him impaled in her windshield and dead, parked her car in her garage, and went to bed with a dead man in her windshield. So that was a very well-known case that took place. I think it's the early 2000s, if I'm not mistaken. Also, when you brought up the Emmett Till case, and I remember during the interview with Mr. Beauchamp that you had discussed the comparison. You thought you had brought up the fact that you thought of Delectable Negro with the title being The Blood of Emmett Till. I thought the same thing, because I missed a healthy portion of the beginning, but when I caught it, I thought about it, and I was like, wow, well, Blood of Jesus, cannibalism, and him comparing basically the body of Emmett Till to the blood of Jesus, and the sacrifice in the same way, and the consumption in the same way. I thought about that as well. So it was just something, a brilliant comparison that you made, Gus, in that segment with Mr. Beauchamp. And I wanted to ask you, there was a clip you played that had a piano track that is just beautiful. And I wanted to ask, what was the name of that song and the artist who played it? I just found that to be a very deeply moving track.
When did you hear it?
It was during like the later clips, and it was like, it was just a piano track, but it was like, I think somebody was talking, or like it was like a clip of a white guy talking, but there was like a prominent piano track that was playing. And you've played it like once or twice before, but I just was fascinated with it.
Huh. If it's a white person talking, and there's a piano in the background, that's a little odd. I'd have to, go back and check to see what it is you heard, or if you pick it out. But, I don't recall selecting any music that was, strictly, keys today.
Okay, so it might have been maybe a part of the news clip then, I'm thinking, but it was just a beautiful piano track that, and I've heard you play it once or twice before. That was really, really just a beautiful solo. And one thing I thought about, I think it might have been Emma that brought up, one of the females before her that brought up the whole idea of how watching The Man in the High Castle, to watch it in proper context, because the music they use can move you in a way where you might take you to a place where you're not watching it in the proper context. And it just made me think, because the Trivium Quadrivium, or the Seven Liberal Arts, basically were utilized by our ancestors to create passion plays, which was supposed to stir, move you in the spiritual direction as far as worship of the deities or spiritual liberation. And what they've done is commandeered those seven liberal arts through things like movies, film, Broadway shows, all of those things, to perpetuate white supremacy and to force us into emotional states of trance in which we identify with white people. So I just thought her assessment was just brilliant, and that's something for all of us to think of when we watch any television show, that that music plays a profound, has a profound impact when it's played in conjunction with the images that you're being shown that might be propagating white supremacy, so that you can think in proper context when watching these people's programs in order to learn more about the system. Thank you very much, and great program, and I'll mute my line.
Can I be heard?
Yes, sir.
Good evening. Good evening, Gus. Good evening to all the callers. Just wanted to say a few things. First, we did the Henrietta Lacks book in the book study session, as you said. And I don't think Rebecca Skloot is a racist suspect. I think she's a flat-out racist, and it showed in her actions in the book. And the Lacks family, personally, they should be trillionaires for, the amount of money. These cells have sold for over the amount of years, and what they've been able to do and cure through research. I mean, they should be the richest people in the world, probably. But, of course, this is a system of racism, white supremacy. There's a movie coming out about the Henrietta Lacks story. And I think it's going to be more focused on Rebecca Skloot, I'm pretty sure. But it's being done by Oprah Winfrey, so I would expect a lot of anti-blackmail stuff to go down in that movie. But I do plan on checking it out just because I read the book. The Grammy Awards, I personally, I always look at the music industry from a control. It's black people's, I guess you could say it's a form of consumption, the black people's artisticness, but they're not getting the compensation for it that they should. And anytime a black artist tries to come up with a way to get compensated correctly, and doing it on their own without having all these white people who set up a system in which they have to be there to do this and do that and do that so they could all make the money, they get punished. Beyonce, she came out with a visual album. Not an album, a visual album. Just put it out, a bunch of videos with the songs were not really the focus. And they cut the industry out completely. They get their money a certain way. The way she did it, it cut them out. And they were very angry when she put that album out. Being that she's the huge star she is, she was still able to persevere and get a lot of shows like the Super Bowl, but of course they demonized her for that. It's been an ongoing thing in the media. I see an attack on her and her husband since they got in a position where they own and control the rights to put out their music and other people's music without a bunch of white hands being involved. So I think that was just a punishment for her not to win the Grammy. Hands down, a much better talent than Adele, who only puts out one song an album, and all of a sudden she's the biggest star in the world. And we always have that white person. It was Celine Dion. It's always one. It's just what it is. I wish she would have came out and said, I'm being punished for that reason. The course in the street part, I think it was in Las Vegas. And I can remember so many people when I grew up getting hit by cars. And it's just like, I don't know if it was just, and now I'm starting to think that it was just a black, something that was, because we were black, and lived in this area. in the way the streets probably were designed or in the lights was situated, because I never thought of it as a racial thing. So I just heard that clip and said, man, I wish I would have had the ability to do the graph and all of that, you know, to find that out back then. But it kind of reminded me of another book. I remember we did Richard Williams, Serena, Venus's father, and him and his friend were collecting bottles and getting the deposit fee for it. And I think it was like the mayor's wife hits his friend. She gets out the car. She said, oh, my God. And she said, oh, it's just a nigger. She got back to her car and drove off, and that was it. And that happens all around the country still to this day. The clip where the guy said that the KKK burnt his house down and left KKK written on the sidewalk and on his house. But when they came to his job, they said, oh, someone left a message at your house. I mean, you know, could you imagine it? You're leaving your work, you know, thinking something, you know, someone might have wrote on your house or it might be a message, or and you come and they never told you that they burnt your house down too. You know, just how white people operate. And the last thing I wanted to say, I don't get the big deal about the Nazis. I mean, they definitely had a few year run doing ethnic cleansing in Europe, but it's nothing compared to these white people we live amongst. Hundreds year plus run of terrorism. You know, you know, concentration camps. We had slavery. You know, we had alligator babies. I mean, nothing. It doesn't even compare. Not even close. And I'll mute my line. Thank you.
Other folks on the line that we have not heard from at all. Any other people that we have not heard from at all.
Greetings, everyone. Can I be heard?
Yes, sir.
Just making sure. Yes. The previous caller got me to be reminded about James Brown's band's drummer, Clyde Stubblefield, being that James Brown is one of my favorite, if not the favorite, entertainer. Clyde Stubblefield was very, very important, very essential. I'm not a music expert, but I do understand that drummers in bands have an important part into a musical instrumental group. And he was one of the best. Matter of fact, Mr. Brown would call on him in a lot of his hits to do a solo. And I'm pretty sure he would also do that in concerts also. So rest in peace, Mr. Stubblefield. Other than that, I've been spending my time learning with the revised version of the United Independent Code Concept book. And Mr. Fuller really did a very good job with the revised version. I don't want to say it's almost like a different book, but it actually, he just really, in his meticulous way, went about the means of really extending from the prior original book. And I'm up to Gus's favorite people activity, sex. And some very interesting thoroughness that he's had in that particular people activity. He actually almost wrote out the all 200 questions that non-white males and non-white females should ask one another before they get serious. He almost wrote out all 200 of them. I think he got up to something like maybe close to 150. And so some very interesting questions too, you know, at that. Basically, I'm just describing not so much about the book, but what I was doing this week, taking some time and reading up on it. And as you know, by it being that late in the people activities, I'm almost finished with it. And that's basically it for right now. Thank you.
For sure. Other folks, if you have commentary you would like to share, go ahead and get your hand up now. We have about 45 minutes left in the program. The number is 641-715-3640. The code is 564-943-pound. Press star 6 if you would like to participate. The person who dialed in, I'm just checking to see if you are talking or, excuse me, if you're listening or if you actually had commentary you were going to share. The caller at 4683 because you're on speakerphone. Did you have commentary or are you just listening? Okay. I'm going to assume that they are just listening because it seems like they're still on speakerphone or what have you. Anybody on the line that we have?
Hey, good evening, everybody. Can I be heard?
Yes, sir.
Can I be heard?
Oh, heard both Hello? Of them. Let's get yes. the female first.
Oh, okay. So I have to have the speakerphone off. Okay. All right. Hi, everyone. I am a first-time caller. One second. Going through my notes. I want to make sure that I get everything together. Okay. I'm from Central Coast, California.
You were a little bit clearer at first. I don't know if you're on speakerphone or something, but you're not as clear.
You were learning about...
Oh, ma'am, can you hear me?
Hello, can you hear me?
Yes, that is clear. If you could start over with your commentary, please.
Sure, I sure can. I'm a first-time caller calling from the Central Coast of California. Just sharing what happened to me today regarding racism. I'm 25, new to learning about this. The Alton Sterling case definitely got me more involved in it. I started seeing a lot of racist things on Facebook, and I wanted to make sure that I had the information and the knowledge to combat the racist things that I was seeing, because it was not okay for people to say the things that they were saying. And then I found a group on Facebook that did anti-racism work, and then I found the
Oh, ma'am, are you still with us? Are you still there? She might have got disconnected. Ma'am, are you still with us?
Today, and his father said something racist.
Oh, ma'am, your audio dropped out. Your audio dropped out for like
how?
Ma'am, can you hear us?
Can you hear me?
Yeah, your audio dropped out when you were sharing. I think you were at the point when you said you found a Facebook group for something, and then it went out for a short period of time.
Okay. So yeah, the anti-racism group on Facebook, got into that because of Alton Sterling, and I wanted to debate and combat the racist things that I was seeing. I'm in a tragic arrangement. My husband is white. We visited his white parents' house today with my two children, and his father said something racist. We were all sitting down, and he was talking about how you teach your kids how to do things, and you know, setting goals, watching the kids set, you know, send the goal for your kid and watching them do it. And then he said something. He said it's good to have a slave. And I said, have you seen a slave work? Because that's the hardest work, you know, you will ever do in your life. And I just, like, with white people, like, all the time, they expect you to say something real nice, a certain way or whatever. In my opinion, I just say it however you feel, however it comes out, say it, because I don't think It's black self-respect to tiptoe around white people's feelings. So I said that to him, and my husband was right there. He laughed in nervousness, which was frustrating because, you know, being white, obviously he doesn't, he's not going to be extremely equipped to do counter-racism work, and he's not even built to do that, you know. So then his sister said something. She's like, can I touch your hair? And I'm like, girl, no, you cannot touch my hair. And I gave her the dirtiest look you can give somebody because I was really pissed off and annoyed by that. And she goes, what? Well, what? I said I liked it. Did you not hear me say I liked it? And I'm just like, I just rolled my eyes because, you know, sometimes you got to realize you can't, you should not explain things to white people. Like, it would have been a burden on me to try to explain to her why her saying, why me, like, why her asking to touch my hair was inappropriate. And I knew that she wouldn't even be receptive to that. And then they have a friend around the corner that came over. The first thing he goes, oh, I like your hair. It's wild. It's crazy. It's cool. Can I touch it? And I said, no, you cannot. Absolutely not. You cannot touch my hair. And he's like, whoa, you know, joking about it. Whoa, you know, I was walking down the street too, and somebody tried to touch my hair. And you know what? I didn't get upset. I was just like, mm-hmm, and you're lying, whatever. And that just goes to show that white people are not stupid when it comes to the system of white supremacy. Like, they know what they're talking about. He knew that it was inappropriate to want to touch my hair after I corrected him. He knew what he was doing was unacceptable, but he still wanted to stick to his guns and just basically make a joke out of it. And white people do that a lot. And you got to call them out on their bull when they do things like that. And I just wanted to say one other thing. when it comes to the whole Beyonce and Adele thing, her speech that Adele gave, oh, Beyonce, I'm sorry you didn't get this award. You are so inspirational to my black friends. Oh, I'm sorry. That's bullcrap, because if she really meant those words, if her words were real, she would have gave that Grammy to Beyonce, because Beyonce deserved it more than her, and that's all I want to say. Thank you. I'll leave my line.
Area H strikes again. Always good to hear from a first-time caller. Man, before I get the male caller who also spoke up, do you think, you said you're in a tragic arrangement, do you think your white male partner is racist?
Do you think my white male partner is racist? Yes. I do believe that all white people are racist. In the system of white supremacy, if you're white, you have certain privileges that other people do, and you grow up in an anti-black system that preys on black people, and you cannot help yourself but to be racist and say and do racist things. So yes, even my husband has to be like, no, what you just said was racist, it's unacceptable. And I constantly have to educate my own husband in my own home about this kind of stuff. And he's pretty receptive to it. And he understands a lot of stuff. At the same time, he's racist too. And I have to continue to basically beat him upside the head and get it out of him, you know. Or I can't get it out of him, actually. It's just a struggle. That's why it's just called a tragic arrangement.
I'm going to guess that that is a metaphor. I don't think that you're literally having to punch him in the head to address his issues of
that
practice.
Was
right. grand to hear from first-time caller. That is fascinating. I'm sure lots of listeners are just scintillated right now, always excited to hear about Area 8. Before they get their questions, if they have any, or if you're even interested in fielding any, the male caller who spoke up simultaneously, did you have commentary, sir?
Yes. Good evening, everybody. Thanks for having me, Gus.
Mm-hmm.
And it's good listening to all the other listeners. Just going to jump around a bit. I'm not going to take too long. First subject is a man in a high castle. Actually, that's the first time I heard about the series or movie or whatever it is today on the call. My thing is, America seems to have a fascination with Hitler and the Nazis. You know, you watch late night TV, there's always some sort of a promotion for a DVD about Hitler and the Nazis. And you see it year after year after year, even though it happened so long ago. Quite honestly, I believe it not only seems like a fascination, but it is a fascination with white racist America. If you follow history, America didn't even enter the war until it was economically viable to do so. For the longest time, they sat and watched the Nazis eliminate the Jews, and nothing was done. And then after Japan entered the war and bombed Pearl Harbor, we decided to get in. And in order to bolster our industry, they decided to get into World War II. So I just think, you know, when those different types of shows come up and, you know, any other shows that, you know, sort of push that type of propaganda, is something that, you know, America wants us to consistently see because they have a fascination with it. That's all I have to say about that one. I'd like to talk a little bit about the Beyonce deal. And I believe the brother from New York, I believe his name is Thomas, mentioned that every time a musician tries to step out on his or her own, they get punished. And that's exactly correct. We just saw Beyonce get punished. We saw, and sometimes it ends up in death. I'm not a big conspiracy theorist, but, you know, I believe Michael Jackson was put to rest because, you know, he had the rights to the Beatles. I mean, they tried to get that back from him so much, and he would not let it go. And eventually he died, and just recently, I believe, his father sold the rights to the Beatles album. I believe the same thing happened to Jimi Hendrix when he became a bit more militant. You know, he got off the drugs and the alcohol. They never talk about that, though. He got off the drugs and the alcohol for a while, and he began to, you know, become more militant in his speech and, you know, become more of an activist for the black community. Shortly after he began to do that, he dies. Same thing with Tupac. You know, he got out of jail. You know, he went to death row and, you know, started talking the gangster stuff and everything. But he moved away from that in his last album. You know, he got more political, more militant, which was his background anyway, Black Panther background. Next thing you know, he's shot to death. So, yeah, I believe the industry is very crooked. And if you don't play their game, they'll find a way to eliminate you. And I believe that's why Beyonce is not going to step up and say how she really feels, because if she does and really tells it like it is, you know, that last album that she made might be very well her last album. Just wanted to touch on that. I had something else that I wanted to touch upon on that. Oh, the statistics that were talked about you know, black folks crossing the street were more likely to be hit. I stay in Delaware now, but I grew up in New York City. And I know when I was coming up, I believe just what Thomas said, every other day, you know, a black kid is hit, a black person is hit. You know, I remember my mother telling me, okay, once you go outside, you know, look both ways. You know, if you're not sure, even when it says walk, you stay there for a while because people are crazy. And in listening to that, I believe my mother was telling me, okay, your black life is worth less than anybody else's out here. And it's a shame that some 30 years later, it's still the same way. You know, my mother, you know, she just graduated high school, but she was very perceptive. And she didn't like getting into, you know, the, you know, racist and, you know, the type of talk that we're talking now about white supremacy, even though she knew about it because, you know, she really tried to shield us away from it. But I believe that's exactly what she was trying to tell me and my three other siblings when we go, you know, when we traveled out and about in New York City. You know, you have to watch out, you know, whether you're crossing the street, going into a store, being approached by a police officer, you know, you just have to have your antennas up at all times. And then one last thing about Henrietta Lacks, it is a shame that her family is not being compensated. And they're still using her actual cells to continue to do research. We know good and well if a white person were to donate any type of their cells or anything for research, they're going to be compensated in some form or fashion. And after hearing that, I just made a personal decision not to donate blood anymore. I've done a little bit of research on that just this past week on donating blood. And, you know, they give you $50 or $60, this, that, and the other. But I was really turned off when I found out that the Red Cross made $2 billion last year from blood donations. So what they do is, you know, pay you a small amount, $50 or $60, but then they resell it to hospitals for 10 times the price, you know. And when you go and look on these websites for blood donations and whatnot, how they promote it is they always have a black or Latino face on that website, you know, because, you know, they figure that, okay, we're the ones that, you know, that need the extra money. You know, they promote that, you know, you can donate blood two or three times a week or something to that effect and make this much money. And, you know, when you scroll from site to site, you see the same faces. And you're like, wait a minute. You know, these guys are actually exploiting us, you know, for our blood for a small amount of money, and they're selling it for 10 times the price to these hospitals.
Hang on,
and
one
when
second.
We go into the hospital, we're getting the worst care.
Hang on,
so,
one second.
I'll leave my line.
Thank you. I just want to make sure we haven't missed everybody. Anybody that we haven't heard from at all? Did you have a commentary you wanted to share? Anybody we haven't heard from at all? Did we get everybody who called in? Everybody been able to share at least one time? We didn't miss anyone? Grand. If you are listening and you have commentary, you should call in now. Please do not wait until the last minute. If you think there's something that you want to add, if it's a question about something that's been brought up, you should go ahead and dial in now, 641-715-3640. The code is 564-943-pound. Press star 6 if you would like to participate. I think if we got everybody, if other folks had commentary that they wanted to share, feel free. Oh, wait a minute. I think Karma. Karma, did you have commentary? Volume is very low. Very, very, very low. Maybe you can turn your microphone volume up. We can hear you. It's just, oh, that's a little better. A little better. Can you turn it up a little bit more?
How about that?
That's one more, maybe? One more?
No, I'm messed up.
Okay, we can hear you. Just make sure that you speak loudly and close to the mic.
I will project. Well, when we were talking about Ms. Lacks' family suffering the medical and economic terrorism, I was thinking about our book read with medical apartheid with, what was her name?
Ms. Harriet Washington.
Yes, Ms. Washington. I just want to grab this part because I saw something on television. It said, longtime Carver Village resident Dorothy Pelote said that a young white man came to our house and talked with me and my husband. They said they were doing a study on mosquitoes and wanted to place a trap in our backyard to see how far they had spread into our area. And later, when people started getting sick and dying, I spoke with several people who recall those boxes being placed in their backyard. So I've seen twice a Microsoft commercial where Microsoft is saying that they have a new mosquito trap to fight Zika virus, which I've already said doesn't cause, you know, microcephaly. It just causes febrile illnesses like Lassa and malaria and yellow fever and dengue fever. But anyway, it's to fight Zika virus, and it's called Project Premonition, and they're rolling it out in Houston. And I went on the site, and I looked at the boxes, and it looks exactly like the same deal. Just a bunch of white people from you know, National Institute of Health or CDC putting boxes out for mosquitoes. And I guess it must have worked beautifully last time because they are rolling out the same exact program. I just can't believe the audacity of rolling out the same exact mosquito program. And people are just like acting like it's no big deal. So if they do that in your area, I'll see what I can do in Houston. But if they do that in your area, please try to put a stop to it. Don't just roll on with it. I was really, really touched, I can't remember the caller's name, really, really touched about the school incident. Because, you know, my sister and I see that what's happening with the students, because we audit and take classes, you know, just to do it, that we have this, they don't know how to read, you know, at the college level. And the professors are frustrated because they don't know why the students, you know, don't know how to read. And it's because they've never had textbooks. I've been saying this. They've never had textbooks. So I challenged the school board last month, and I told them our children haven't had textbooks for 5 years. We did have some, but they put them in the closet, and I think they just sold them at a yard sale or something. So it's so deliberate. It's so awful. So I've challenged them to bring back the textbooks, and they've explained to me patiently, well, Karma, you know, I told them, I said, you have $17 million. Each child should have two sets of textbooks, one for at home and one for at school. That's what we're going to do. We're going to do that right now. It's going to be $1.25 million for each set, and we're going to do that every year without fail. And so they discussed it, and they came back to tell me, oh, what you don't understand is we've only set aside $160,000 a year for textbooks. Out of $17 million a year, they give me some asinine statement like we only set aside $160,000 according to the state for textbooks. And that is supposed to be logical. That is supposed to make sense to me. And I am supposed to understand that. These are the most beastly, ghastly people, and I will do my best to make sure no one goes to school when it starts for the next school year. The last part, the terrorist, Dylann, the other terrorist who is emulating Dylann Roof, I guess, he said they were born for that, and we need to take them at their word. Thank you for listening.
Right on. Good to hear from Karma. Did you have commentary? Anybody that we missed have commentary, making sure we got everyone? If we did, then if other folks have anything else that they want to add, feel free.
I wanted to add something.
Yes, ma'am.
I just wanted to add, it wasn't clear when I was speaking about my white husband's father and what he said about I just don't think it was clear. And what I learned from this show is
your audio isn't clear as it was before.
Hello? Yeah, much I just felt like it didn't make sense what I was saying about how he was teaching the kids how to do things and you know, like taking things to the trash and cleaning up toys and things like that. And then he made a joke that about them kids doing things like that for you. And then he said, oh, it's good to have a slave.
So I just wanted to be extremely clear on that, and just for all my people listening, that it's always okay to come back to the person and say, you know, earlier what you said, you know, you had said this earlier, and I thought about it, and you know, then give your response, and it's always okay to do that.
Good point. I think that's important for workplace as well. If a white person does something incorrect, says something, and you want to address it, I said that if you want to take time, get your words together, what you want to say. If it's a question you want to ask, you can always take time, think about it, and then go back and address the issue.
Can I be heard?
Yes, sir.
Thanks. Greetings to you guys once again. Thanks for the opportunity to speak. I just wanted to bring up an article that actually a black male who actually reached out to me from another program that I do actually sent me an article that is actually about 7 years old, but I just found the title very interesting. And when I read it, it was it just confirms everything that a lot of us who are less confused understand. The title was "White People Lack Empathy for Brown People, Brain Research Shows." And it was basically a neuroscientist who had done studies with white people where they used video footage of white people and non-white people performing different tasks. And they measured the brainwave response of the white people as they were watching white people and non-white people performing the same task, and found that just from their research and the different groups of people that they interviewed, that essentially white people, because of their lack of melanin, have no lack empathy for non-white people. So, again, it just leads back to genetic annihilation, and it was a fascinating article. I'll send it to you, Gus, as well, but it was just a fascinating article. And also, for the person, I think it was a black female who brought up the program on C-SPAN 2 on the blood of Emmett Till, I'd like to thank you for that, because I actually see that it's coming on tomorrow morning, so I'm going to watch it on C-SPAN 2. But also, I saw, just as I was just going through the guide, they're also going to have a program on price for their pound of flesh. They're interviewing the black female author of that book as well, and it's supposed to be sometime tomorrow, I think later on in the day, or in the evening time. So I just wanted to let everyone know, if you do have access to C-SPAN 2, that they will be interviewing or having a discussion with the author of Price for Their Pound of Flesh. And then also there should be showing a second time the Blood of Emmett Till and the interview with Dr. Timothy Tyson. I thank you, and I'll mute my line.
That's Dana Ramey Berry, black female. She's the author of Price for a Pound of Flesh. That's a good book. It just came out, but I do have it. And that's the one where she talks about one of the aspects very closely connected to the delectable Negro. She emphasizes the sale of enslaved black people after they died, which also comes up in medical apartheid. But she said that's one of the things she covers in her book, how that was a market in and of itself, another way that black people were ritually consumed, continues to this day. Other folks have commentary they want to get in, questions, anything else to bring up?
Can I be heard?
Yes, ma'am.
I'd like to comment on just a couple of things. Unfortunately, I couldn't figure out how to make them linear or succinct, so here goes. The first thing, I wanted to think about, well, you know, why are we making such a big deal about the Nazis? It's true that the Yoruba Americans here were pretty horrific, but I think the element that makes it a little bit more like terrifying or something like that, I guess, is how systematic it was and how effective it was and how in such a short time too. Like the white Americans here, they had 400 years they were doing it. The European German had, like, I don't know exactly how long it lasted, but way less than hundreds of years. And the way that they did it was, it started off with some, like, there, I'm reading a book, The Destruction of the European Jew, and he talks about how all of the so-called Nazi laws were originally just German laws to begin with. But I think the thing that makes it so, like, whoa, or makes it, that might be a metaphor even though it wasn't a real word, that makes it something to consider as different is just really the precision with which they did it and the precision and the setting up of a like icon that now it's like a label. So everyone can be like this whole Nazi way. And it's like back in that 1950s, you know how they glorify a time period. It's like time stamped like that as well. So it makes it something to easily recall because of the way that everything happened. But that's just a postulation, like something I was thinking about. The other thing I wanted to mention, like, you know, as a female, sometimes, I don't know, like, there's just an assumption that a lot of females are into, like, a lot of things. I didn't even know what anybody was talking about with the whole Beyonce thing and Adele thing until, like, right now. I think I finally understood what happened. And no shade or, like, no disrespect to anybody, especially Beyonce. But I really don't think that that is indicative of anything. I think that there's a lot of things that are staged and planned for various reasons. And for all we know, that could have just been staged and planned that Adele did that. And I haven't listened to Beyonce's album, so it could be fantastic and I just don't know. I didn't listen to Adele's album. It could be fantastic and I don't know. But I think it's just like another distraction. So sometimes I feel like when people, you know, I don't pay it any attention. I just don't think it's even really that relevant. And then the last thing that I wanted to talk about was the, like, we keep hearing a lot of clips about, like, young kids who are experiencing overt racism to a degree in their schools. I'm all about the health. And I don't ever really hear too much talk about what health, like mental health that these students receive at all. And not that that, you know, means that it's not happening, but I really feel like there's no conversation at all that's being had that puts us in proper context. We talk about putting white people in proper context, but really putting ourselves in proper context. Like, there has not ever been a moment when we've received any type of compassion or proper context as to why we're behaving the way that we're behaving, why we're doing things, why this is how it is, and what to do. And I think that, like, when I think about it, because I personally, from what I can see right now, I think we're moving into a very, very Nazi-like situation. And people are so confused because they're like, well, Adele broke her Grammy or whatever it was for Beyonce and all of these so-called biracial children. That's only like all of the other like dark black people who they don't want, I think will be the ones that will get gone, like will be killed, executed, put in the internment concentration camp. And the new black people who are even more confused than those of us who understand because we're darker, we don't have any of those passes or we don't have a white parent or anything like that, are the ones that, you know, they'll be the black people and they will be in their position and white people will show them their new face. Like, oh, I know you're my, you know, we can't deny, like, white people rape black people and put their own children into slavery. So that doesn't mean anything that they have children with black people now. I'll leave it there. I just think that that's where we're headed. Like, the evidence that I see, that's just it. The propaganda, like, that's really what the man in the high castle is. I, too, vote for the book, so I'm down, guys. But that's all that is. It's like it's charging them up. It's gearing them up, and it's going to show its face really soon. And I think it will look very reminiscent of Nazi Germany. Thanks.
Can I be heard?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, I wanted to say that I was in a political science class at Michigan State University, and it was taught by Professor Jacob Franek from, I believe it was the Ukraine. And he was a blonde-haired, blue-eyed person who I later learned, this was well after the class took place, that he was also classified as a Jewish person. So I didn't know that going into this class. However, when I was in the class, we paid
tremendous amount of attention to the Holocaust that took place in Nazi Germany. And he, I wanted to ask the class, and this, I guess, was a big deal. I asked, what made the, why are we paying so much attention to the Jewish Holocaust? Why does the, why is the genocide that took place against the Jewish or the European Jewish population at that time, why do we make such a big deal out of it? And there was a lot of back and forth between myself and the professor, and I wanted to get him to really just admit what he was talking about. And then he paused for a moment in front of the entire class, and he said, well, the reason why the Jewish Holocaust was so important and it's so out of the ordinary compared to the tremendous amount of genocides that have taken place throughout history is because the victims of the Holocaust in German society were white at one point. And they were at one point considered part of the society. And then he listed the number of German Jewish philosophers, artists, just members of Jewish society. And it got me to thinking that the German Jewish people were in a far superior position at the time of the Holocaust socially than the black people currently are in the United States. Black people in the United States typically do not have art to steal. We typically do not have property to loot that we own, most of us. And on top of that, we are already located in ghettos. Part of the Nazi process was to ghettoize the German Jewish population. So we're already in that situation. And I just wanted to make a mention of that. And I just wanted to also impress the fact that, yes, a Jewish person from Europe told me that the only reason why the German Jewish Holocaust was so significant was that the victims were white. That's it.
May I be heard?
Yes, ma'am.
I definitely appreciate him still saying that, because I remember when I was in high school, I had to learn about every death camp, how many people were killed in every death camp. It was something that you had to memorize, and then also having to learn about that. That was actually, I'm sorry, in middle school, and then continue to learn about it in high school, and even had to learn or even had to read, I think, Night by Elie Wiesel. I'm not sure if I'm saying his name right, but then I started to think about, they never quite spoke about, if they did speak about the teachers, that is, if they did speak about, like, the eugenics program when it came to the Jews, they never actually spoke about the origins and where the Nazis got the idea from. So I definitely thought that that was curious, and I'm definitely glad that he shared that information as to, I'm sure that like some of the listeners on the line probably already came to this conclusion, but that definitely makes sense, is because we have to realize, well, it was just whites killing whites, which is more important than whites killing massive numbers of blacks at any point in time over any given amount of years. And then also I wanted to actually, I forgot to mention when I first spoke with, I definitely wanted to thank MA for just her commentary from last week about the questions and stuff, because that actually was what helped me to report the dentist office. So I didn't want to get that out of the way, and I wanted to get that out of the way, and also to thank the other people who provided their feedback. That's all I have. Thank you.
For sure. The caller, I just want to make sure we didn't miss anybody. The caller is 7722. Are you with us?
Yes, I am. Thank you. May I speak?
Yes, sir.
Yes, greetings to the host and to the other callers. Just getting in late, attempting to earn some coin this evening. I was going to share with the listeners, I the person known as Jane Elliott is visiting Kansas City, this part of the world, and there has been much ado about that among non-white people, more than I, of course, probably like. I believe that there has been more confusion sowed among non-white people because of, she's been a guest on the program, I believe, at least once, maybe more than one time. I think I've heard one of the programs, but the issue that I wanted to bring up was that the amount of non-white people that were attending these events, not only the anecdotal RSVPs via social media websites, but the pictures that were shown to me. I wanted to attend one of them because I've never heard her speak live. Extremely suspicious of white people who draw crowds of up to 2,000. You know, when you have people, solid brothers and sisters who come to lay serious, constructive, life-saving information, and there's about 60 or 70 non-white people in the room, and you have a white person who comes to speak about racism, and because of some viral videos, draws literally thousands, majority non-white individuals into auditoriums, just really shows how refined racist man, racist woman is. I do look forward, I believe Eddie Moore Jr. is coming to visit the city in a couple of days, I believe tomorrow, so I'm trying to go here, of course, definitely. Here, Mr. Moore, hopefully, sans his girlfriend, but it will be a very good opportunity to learn more about, you know, the efforts. White Privilege Conference is also going to be here, so I'm looking forward to that, but if anybody was going to be attending in Kansas City, I'll take my call offline.
Right on. Before I nab Thomas in New York, I was just going to say that clip on literacy, I'd be interested in getting the author as a guest on the program. It reminded me, I think anytime that we have those discussions on black people and literacy rates, I think it should be mandatory. You know, it was in many regions in this part of the world, it was a death sentence for a black person to know how to read. I think that factors into any of those issues with reading comprehension. Particularly, I bring it up every time we talk about the state of Virginia. Whites closed public schools for 5 years. Does that have an impact on a particular group's literacy rates and how they feel about education? I mean, white people have done a number of things all along the way, in addition, like Karma said, so that black people don't have textbooks and end up being suspended from schools. And just, they have done so many things to make it so that black people are not well educated, have very low reading rates. And then they stand back, oh, I can't, that's amazing. The Negroes can't read. Mm. Thomas in New York, did you have commentary you were going to get in?
Yes, and I was going to speak to Karma and say that if I was in her position, you know, textbooks are very important, but they are of the past. You can get all the textbooks you want, stream them or however through the companies that make them using a computer. So I would probably push to make sure every kid gets a laptop or a Chromebook, as opposed to textbooks. You know, that would open up a conversation. You know, are we giving the kids the best education? This is the technical world. You know, maybe get some satisfaction that way. And I just wanted to say, you know, I've done a lot of reading, and I'm very interested in doing a book study session on this book as well. But, you know, I've done a lot of reading on the Nazis and what was done to the so-called Jewish people. And it just doesn't compare. It just, you know, they wasn't hanging pregnant Jewish women and then cutting the baby out and letting her while she's singing, you see them stomp on the baby's head. It wasn't like that for them. And they died very dignified compared to how our ancestors died here. You know, then let's not just, more than just to say, they sent their people here to learn eugenics and things. We weren't going there trying to learn. These white people here weren't sending people there trying to learn how to oppress and dominate people. They sent their people here to learn how to cheat the Jews. I'm your mom, thank you.
Right on. With that, we will call it a broadcast, mostly because we will be here in about 12 hours. The Global Sunday Talk on Racism will be here tomorrow. We should have Nancy, for people who didn't get to hear. She was with us from Belgium just a few weeks back. She should be with us tomorrow. So we'll have, I think, representation from Belgium, Austria, England. I even asked Marquise down in Brazil if he wanted to visit back with us. So lots of different parts of the globe having non-white people coming to participate. It is a little bit earlier, obviously, because the time difference and everything, but 3 p.m. Eastern, 2 p.m. Central, 12 noon Pacific tomorrow. That would be Sunday, the 19th. We'll be looking forward just 90 minutes to discussing racism, white supremacy. It's been a lot. In Belgium, there was a young black person who was attacked. It was a victim of a knife attack. That's what it was in Belgium. Nancy had just told me about that. The incident in France that got a lot more of attention, where it was a black teen was anally sodomized by enforcement officials. Marine Le Pen is looking like she's going to win in France. I mean, it's been quite a few things happening globally. And to get our international listeners' thoughts on the first, I guess, month of the Trump administration. But that'll be tomorrow. Tune in. Looking forward to hearing racism discussed from a global perspective. If you have questions, problems, can't find something in the archives, drop us an email, untiljustice@gmail.com. We'll try to respond promptly. Hope it has been a constructive investment of your Saturday evening. For folks tuning in, again, sobriety would be best under conditions of white supremacy. I do not think being under the influence is going to help us, any black person, any non-white person, if we are stopped by Daniel Holtzclaw, Darren Wilson, any other race soldier, badge or no, I don't think being intoxicated is going to put us in the best position to neutralize that situation and get home to people who care about us safe and sound, unharmed. In fact, I think there's a lot of evidence that being intoxicated makes it much easier for racists to terrorize and dominate us. That said, Creator, we ask that you help us remain patient with other black people, victims of white supremacy. We ask that you help us remain patient with ourselves. Remind us to demonstrate the highest levels of black self-respect at all times, in all places, each and every time we are in contact with another black person. It has been time. Replace white supremacy with justice immediately. Cal signing out. Thanks all for tuning in.
Nigga, you so brainwashed.
I'm a victim,
your
brother.
Problem. You're a victim.
Shut I'm a up. Victim of 400 years of conditioning.
Shut up.
The man has programmed my conditioning.
Mm-hmm.
Even my conditioning has been conditioned.